of 52.92, a new high school national record. Back to back to back to back state champions. NET Sports, Nebraska's home for championship sports, is live from Memorial Stadium in Lincoln, Nebraska for the 2017 NSAA Football Championships. And this afternoon in Class C2, it's the Chieftains of UTAN taking on the undefeated Broncos of Centennial. And hello again, everyone. I'm Larry Putney, along with former Husker Matt Davison. Great to have you with us here for this afternoon's game. It's not often you see a team start out 0-3 and make it to the state championship game, but that's what UTAN has done this year. And they've got some great play from a running back named Brylon Mitacucci.
That's right, Larry. He's a senior running back, and he has over 1,800 yards on the season and 17 touchdowns. But let's remember, that's in just 10 games. As you said, they started out, lost their first three, won their next nine, but really only played seven games because they had two teams that couldn't show up to play those nights. So those are big-time numbers for this little running back in just 10 games this season.
Centennial comes in undefeated. They really count on the arm and the feet of their quarterback, Riot Ellers.
Yeah, Ellers is a good player. He's a junior, 6 feet, 180 pounds, and over 1,800 yards and 22 touchdowns, as you can see there. But it's not just him. He's what makes everything go. But they also have a running back with over 1,100 yards in Gavin Avery. Both of those guys are what makes Centennial's offense so tough to stop.
Third member of our crew is braving the cold and temperatures and the wind out of the field. Let's go down to Sean.
Hey, guys, you look at these two teams. They know each other very well. In fact, this will be their fourth meeting in 15 months. Obviously met earlier in the year with Centennial winning over UTAN. But last year in the first round of the playoffs, it was UTAN that won 34-6 over Centennial. So both clubs very familiar with each other, kind of a rivalry back and forth. And we should be in for a good one just with that inner knowledge back and forth on both sides here.
Wow, four times 15 months. That's unusual. You see a team that many times within the period of just over a year. Here's a look at the schedule for UTAN. You look at that start that they had. They went 0-3 to start, losing to Battle Creek. They lost to Centennial, and they also lost to Loganview. And then they had the forfeit. So through four games, they were 1-3. Through six, they were 3-3, and somehow managed to go on a run and make it down here to state.
Close games, though, that they lost early on. You look at Centennial, they've won them all. But look at the game that was the closest, UTAN, 28-25. That's what makes me interested in this one. And Sean said it, when you've seen each other that much, man, you got a lot of film to look at. And coaching is going to be a big part of this game because of how much film they have on each other.
Centennial comes in number one seed, ranked number one. UTAN looking to avenged that early season loss to Centennial, 28-25, and that touchdown was scored with just 41 seconds left in the game. So they led most of the way, 41 seconds left. Centennial scores and takes the lead. There's a look at the tournament resume for UTAN, 350 enrollment. This is their 17th trip to the postseason of the NSAA, third appearance in the championship finals. And they have been runners-up twice in 85 and 88. So the Chieftains looking for that school's first ever state championship. Two times a bridesmaid, never the bride here in Lincoln. And look at Centennial's resume. 109 is their enrollment. 21st trip here at state. Second trip into the finals. And they were runners-up back in 1976. So someone is going to walk away with the first ever state championship. That's always a fun one to do when you see a school take home their first.
Yeah, and exciting for a community. We talk about, you know, the last game, you have two teams that have been here a bunch, two teams that are used to coming to Lincoln. Well, these two communities, this is going to be the first one of these babies for one of these teams. And so you can bet everybody in town is here today, and they can't wait to watch this game. I expect, Larry, I'm going to predict this, it's going to be the closest one that you've had this week.
All right.
It's not saying much. I think this is going to be a close one here this afternoon.
Let's hope you're right. The first one certainly was, and as you said, they know each other. So, hey, I want to remind you, you can watch NET on our app. Just download it at netnebraska.org/app. Get full profiles of players, fully profiles. You can watch these games anywhere on the NET Nebraska app. We are getting ready for the Class C2 State Championship. Good crowd on hand on a chilly afternoon. The sun has come out, but still, it is a breezy one with the wind gusting up to 30 miles an hour here at Memorial Stadium. About ready for introductions for both of these teams, and for that, let's go to Steve Lemon.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Memorial Stadium and the 2017 Nebraska School Activities Association Football Championships. Today's Class C2 State Championship game features the UTAN Chieftains and the Centennial Broncos. Now for the introduction of the players and coaches. Here are the UTAN Chieftains. Number 4, Brett Eyerts. Number 5, Chase Burchell. Number 9, Griffin Hendricks. Number 15, Clayton Nelson. Number 22, Ryland Menicucci. Number 23, Blake Hutton. Number 36, Ethan Abraham. Number 47, Alan Leahy. Number 51, Sam Elgert. Number 60, Colton Feast. Number 62, Jaden Stewart. Number 66, Lucas Howells. Number 68, Cole Egger. And number 81, Preston Pierce. The head coach of the Chieftains is Dan Krychak. And now, the rest of the UTAN players and coaches.
So there are the Chieftains, 9-3 on the year. They opened up the season, as we said, with three consecutive losses. Battle Creek Centennial, Loganview picked up a forfeit win, and then went in a bit of a streak to get here. Here's a comparison of these two teams. UTAN at averages 27.8 per game, Centennial just over 30. The points allowed are very similar. The yards per game, just about 30 difference. The big difference here is the all-important takeaways, 43 for Centennial.
We saw it in the last game.
Right.
Big part of the first championship game here today. See if it's another big part of it in this one here.
Now back to Steve for the introduction of the Centennial top-ranked team, Broncos.
And now, here are the Centennial Broncos. Number 3, Jackson Hirschfeld. Number 6, Max Holmes. Number 7, Reese Foreman. Number 16, Cooper Guerin. Number 22, Wyatt Ellers. Number 38, Gavin Avery. Number 41, Hayden Richters. Number 45, Heath Haberman. Number 51, Tyler Perry. Number 57, Caleb Cast. Number 68, Quinn Butsky. Number 72, Garrett Bellhoffer. And number 78, Colton Bowers. The head coach of the Broncos is Evan Klonensky. Here are the rest of the Centennial players and coaches.
So here come the Centennial Broncos.
12-0, number one ranked, number one seed. And let's find out where these two teams come from. UTAN, both of the eastern part of the state. UTAN and Centennial, how did they get here to Memorial Stadium? UTAN knocked off Valentine and then Battle Creek 21-0 in the semifinals. Centennial picked up wins over Central City and also Lincoln Lutheran. So UTAN and Centennial here in this C2 state championship game at Memorial Stadium.
Well, I know you were wondering, Larry. I'll go ahead and tell you. I have played against UTAN in basketball and football, but not against Centennial. Let's just get it out there.
No, I wasn't the only one wondering, Matt. The entire audience was wondering. Yeah, let's go to Steve Lemon.
On behalf of the Nebraska School Activities Association and its member schools, welcome to the 2017 NSAA State Football Championship Finals. Ladies and gentlemen, please rise and remove your hats to honor America with the singing of our national anthem. Our anthem this afternoon will be sung by the Sydney High School Sextet under the direction of Miss Jennifer Mead.
Ready to go. Class C2 state title when we come back at Memorial Stadium. Should be a good one. The Chieftains and the Broncos for the C2 title when we come back on NET Sports.
The Nebraska Chiropractic Physicians Association is pleased to sponsor the NSAA Academic All-State Award Program, recognizing students and athletes who shine in the classroom and on the field. This statewide program recognizes academic excellence, leadership, and athletic achievement in over 20 high school sports and activities. We honor these exceptional students and all of the teachers, coaches, and parents who have mentored them. Together, we can continue to make Nebraska a great place to live, learn, and play.
When you're looking for Nebraska's stars of tomorrow, start with the young Nebraskans in 4-H and FFA. That's why Constellation has contributed more than $197,000 to 4-H and FFA in the 60 Nebraska counties we serve. Constellation supplies natural gas for Nebraska homes, farms, ranches, and businesses. By supporting 4-H and FFA, we're providing energy for Nebraska's stars of tomorrow as well. Natural gas supply from Constellation.
Talk about public power for a second. Nebraska's electric utilities use a diverse mix of fuel resources to generate electricity. Wind, water, coal, nuclear, natural gas, solar, and methane. Just another way your electric utility shows how public power works for you. Let's talk about public power for a second. Did you know Nebraska's electric utilities pay more than $100 million to communities they serve each year? Those dollars stay local, helping to empower our hometowns. Just another way your electric utility shows how public power works for you.
The values that Methodists bring is family.
It's important going through school that you're not just a number, that you're a face and that you're a name to a teacher. And so I loved the small class sizes.
What it means to me is that I found my foundation where I can build on my passion and I can embrace something new in my life. It is a place where I know that I'm supposed to be.
Nobody starts 0-3 and then comes back to the state championship. I don't think it's ever been done. They might have three losses, but starting 0-3 and then battling your way back, we got the bigger hearts. You just got to go out there and show it. proud of you.
That was UTAN head coach Dan Krychek, sixth season, 35-17. He's done a terrific job in bringing this team back from 0-3 to make it here to Memorial Stadium. These two teams scored off earlier this year. Wasn't quite this chilly. It certainly was not this windy as well. We've got a cold one here at Memorial Stadium, and the flags are, well, there's Evan Klonetsky, head coach of Centennial. Klonetsky, eighth year, 51-26.
Tough to win them all, Larry. They've won them all so far.
Yeah, right.
And a chance to finish it off here today, but their toughest game of the year, closest game of the year, was against these Chieftains of UTAN.
So ready to kick it away. Here is Blake Hutton with the kickoff in the C2 title game here at Memorial Stadium. Back deep is Reese Foreman. A short kick will be taken at the 25-yard line. Driven out of bounds at the 32. And that's where Centennial will begin. Broncos come in 12-0, averaging 30.3 points per game, 336 yards per game. That offense led by Wyatt Ehlers. Ehlers, the quarterback for the Broncos. 6 foot, 180 pound junior. Back there with Ehlers is Gavin Avery as they look to the sideline for the play here on first and 10. Ball at the 31-yard line. Ehlers gives it right to the midline. No gain there. In fact, maybe a loss of one on the play. That front line of Lucas Powell's, Jaden Stewart, and Colton Feast will be tough. And there is a look at Colton Feast. He is an animal in the middle.
Yeah, big dude, Larry. Powell's is 260 and Feast is 230, and both well over 6 feet. So big dudes in the middle that Centennial's gonna have to try to move around today.
Yeah, Feast has a, get this, a combined bench, squat, and deadlift of over 1,200 pounds.
I never got that.
Here's up the middle, Ehlers with the opportunity, and first carry for Ehlers, and that's enough for a first down.
Well, both of these guys can really hurt you. And we talked about Ehlers at the top, and then we talked about Gavin Avery as well. Ehlers here keeps it and is able to get up the middle. You can see at the end of the run there, too, how he finishes these runs. He's 180 pounds, and so he's going to be a load for these secondary players for UTAN if he gets to the next level.
And there he is again inside. It's Colton Feast with the hit. Not much there for Wyatt Ehlers.
Off the right side, they've gone up the middle. You'll see the zone read a bunch. UTAN is going to have to be disciplined today. They've seen this. You know they saw it earlier in the year. They've seen it three times, as Sean said, in the last 15 months. And they've watched film of it over and over and over again. Maybe the team that has a wrinkle or two today is the team that has the advantage.
Ehlers back there with Avery. Ehlers will keep it rolling to his left. Nothing there. Pulls it down. Ball on the ground. Looks like it rolled right into a Bronco. There on the recovery was Gavin Avery to save the possession.
I think we saw 11 or 12 fumbles in that first game.
Yeah.
And about half of them were recovered by the other team. This one fortunate for Centennial that it ends up in a Bronco hand, because Ehlers tries to put it away, but on a cold day like this, you have to be even more cognizant of taking care of the football.
That'll bring up third down, third and three. Ehlers looks to his right, pulls it down. He'll run the drop play. He needs to get to the 45, to the 43, and he does not. That will bring up a fourth down here early on, right near midfield. This will be an interesting decision.
Yeah, he got knocked forward for the last yard or so of that run, and it looks like Centennial's going to punt it.
Early on, play the field position game. Not a bad play for head coach Evan Klonetsky. Eighth year, 51-26.
see these programs that stick with a coach and have him around for many years. And these kids have been with him since they were in elementary school, so they know what the program's all about.
That'll roll dead at about the 16-yard line. And that's where UTAN will have its first possession of the game.
In these smaller communities, when you have a coach that's been around a long time, they can see these kids grow up and they kind of know what they have coming. And Centennial knew they were going to be good again this year.
Early on, first quarter action here in the C2 title game. We'll be back in Lincoln in just a moment.
Participating in Nebraska high school activities has taught me about teamwork.
I've learned how to lead among my peers.
At my high school, I have set goals and I work hard to accomplish them.
I like to run on my cross country team. It makes me feel good about myself.
The Nebraska School Activities Association providing opportunities in 25 activities in our 303 high schools. NSAA activities, the other half of education.
Not just on the good days. Not just on the challenging ones. Not just during business hours. Or when relaxing. But always, for the past 125 years, Farmers Mutual of Nebraska, always alongside you.
Back at Memorial Stadium, there is Evan Klinetsky. Let's go down to the field to Sean Callahan.
Guys, I was in the Centennial locker room here to hear Coach Klinetsky's pregame words to his team, and they were pretty simple. He said, let's do what we've done all year, do our job, and let's bring home the first state championship in Centennial history.
Sometimes a simple message is a good one. Yeah. It's pretty simple. Go out, do what we do all year.
Hendricks hands in the backfield to Minicucci. We talked about Minicucci, 1,800 plus yards on the season, 5'10 sophomore, about 150.
Well, it's a lot of yards in 10 games. Oh.
Second down and four. Griffin Hendricks is sophomore. Toss out to Minicucci, looking for that corner, not quite to the first down line. Brings up third down and short for the Chieftains.
Just tossed it to the short side of the field. Had one extra blocker there. And nice gain on second down. Sets up a really manageable third down. Chase Purchill and Griffin Hendricks, guys we really need to watch. For UTAN and for Centennial, Caleb Cast on defense. You have over 100 tackles. You are making some plays on that side of the ball.
Quick hit up the middle. And that is Ethan Abraham with the carry and the first down.
So the first big third down of the game for UTAN. And they say, hey, we're going to give it to the first guy through. And easily picks up the first down. Nice game.
So first down and 10. Ball placed at the 31 for the Chieftains. And misdirection here. Not much there for Brylan Minicucci.
Now Minicucci did well there just to get a yard out of it. Tried to pull the guard around from right to left, little counter play. And Minicucci had to really hug that guard up into the hole just to get it back to the line of scrimmage and maybe get one out of it.
Hendricks under center on second down and nine. Hendricks rolls to his left under some pressure, and he'll be brought down. Nice defensive play on the right side by Caleb Cast.
We talked about Cast. 102 tackles on the year. That might be his biggest one, though. That's a big play here in the state finals. to be able to get him to the ground out there in the open field. Cass is a big dude. He gets Hendricks, pulls him down, and forces a big third down and 16 now.
Leads the team with those 102 tackles, also leads the team with 9 sacks, and that brings, as you said, a long third and 16. On the option, pitch to the right, nothing there. Minicucci hit first and knocked down. Max Tomes was the first man there, cleaned up by the rest of that defensive front. Haberman there to close it out.
It's amazing, one bad play, one negative play. It seemed like UTAN had something going on this drive. They just go with an option play to try to get something out of it. Probably didn't think they'd get 16 out of it. Instead, Centennial comes up, plays it perfectly. Assignment football to the wide side of the field. And a big loss again, and UTAN will be punting it out of the shade.
So Bradley Minicucci had to kick it away. Low line drive kept out of the wind, will not be taken by Foreman. He lets it roll down inside the 35, down to the 34-yard line. So after a promising start for the Broncos, a couple of big plays for the Chieftains, a couple of big plays by the Broncos.
Well, you get a 50-yard punt, that'll help you.
Absolutely.
That was a big punt. A little wind behind him, but it was kind of a roller. He just kind of hit a toppler end over end. And that was a nice play for UTAN special teams.
Out of the field to Sean Callahan.
Line, because they really needed to field that punt to minimize the damage, and it worked out pretty well for UTAN getting that bounce on the ground. What really was a punt that probably should have been returned.
Yeah, I would agree. Jaden Stewart there on the play along with Brett Hyerts. Hyerts from that defensive end or that wide linebacker spot.
Yeah, nowhere to go there. Really good job. Stewart, the senior, on the right side. It's a pretty good front for UTAN. Both sides of the ball, they have some size for a school in C2.
We're seeing a little bit of these two teams knowing each other very well here early on. The big plays that we've seen have been nice individual efforts, individual plays, more so than scheme.
Injury for UTAN. See who that is down there. Slow to get up.
Yeah.
Left shoulder.
Knee in the back by Colton Feast. You get knee to the back from the senior that goes 230.
Yeah, Feast hit his own guy unintentionally, obviously, but.
Tipped away. Nice defensive play by Ethan Abraham. Second time we've called his name today. Abraham.
That's a good job. Good job, Larry, knocking that one away. Had his eyes on the quarterback, was able to come off of his man and knock the pass away. It was intended for the guy in the slot. So really good job there in the zone to come over and knock it away and force the punt.
Punt it away.
The wind just grabbed it, Larry, and pushed it left to right. It was kind of a floater. And that'll tell you what the wind is going to do to the team going north today. That thing went, 10 yards?
Well, let's take a look at last year's Class C2 state championship in this flashback.
Wilbur Claytonia cruised to their first football Class C2 state championship after shutting out Crofton 20-0. After a scoreless first half, Wilbur Claytonia's quarterback, Tanner Sand, ended the scoring drought by finding wide receiver Bryce Boz for a 29-yard touchdown pass. Sand would later run to 2 red zone touchdowns, while Wilbur Claytonia's smothering defense continued to hold Crofton in check. Crofton only gained 48 yards of total offense on 44 plays in a loss that gave Wilbur Claytonia their first Class C2 football state championship.
Back here at Memorial Stadium, 3:54 to go here in the first quarter between UTAN and Centennial. No score on the board, but look out, Chieftains
have terrific field position. They start inside Bronco territory at the 49-yard line. Give to Minicucci again. Minicucci had a bit of breathing room there, and then he's popped right there by Tyler Perry just past the line. Perry with 54 tackles on the year.
Looks like a linebacker, doesn't he? Number 51, Tyler Perry, senior, stepped up in the hole there and hit Minicucci with great pad level. We saw the earlier game, Larry, though, the field position was so big. The wind played a big role in that field position. We just saw it with the awful punt from Centennial, and now UTAN with a great chance to get points.
Again, Minicucci through that line and a first down on the carry out to the down to the 35-yard line for UTAN.
Well done. Downhill for Minicucci. Not a big fella, as we said, but he can make you miss. He gets to the second level. Watch this cut. Boom. Off to the right, makes another man miss. A little spin to get two or three more and a first down.
You can see that quickness through the hole for the sophomore. Minicucci again trying to step his way through, and Hayden Richters, the middle linebacker for the Broncos, in on the tackle.
Took a pretty big shot right there. Richters was able to hit him low. That's pretty good. Another thing that makes Minicucci tough to bring down is just not a lot to hit at 5'9 and 155. Good pad level coming through the hole. Richters that time did a good job getting low.
Back to throw this time. Here's Hendricks. Hendricks going deep down the field. Come back for it and picked off. Intercepted at the 5-yard line, and that's where the Broncos will have it. Picked by Reese Foreman. He has 4 interceptions on the year.
Foreman won the jump ball, Larry. They tried to hit their man in the slot. One-on-one coverage. And Hendricks tried to find him, but he just kind of threw it up there, and Purchill went up to try to get it too, but Foreman was able to come down with it. Fortunately, they were able to tackle him right there.
I was still loose for a second, and you saw coming in there late was the wide receiver, Alan Leahy, who had an opportunity to maybe even pull it out. Nice job and effort and focus by Foreman. So back to the Broncos, first down from their own 5, a gain of 3 on first down, and the carry out to the 8-yard line by Gavin Avery. One more look at this.
It goes up, kind of pins it against his helmet. The ball's still kind of rolling around. It was loose, but he got it back.
Like if Leahy doesn't come in there late, he might have not gotten that. Leahy kind of pushed
it
back.
It. Yeah.
Pushed it back into his body. Yeah.
Pass out there to the right to Foreman. Purchill made the tackle. So a third down, and remember, into the wind again.
Yeah.
If they could get a stop here, with there'd be under a minute to go, it would be big if they could stop them here, make them punt it into the wind. Big third down.
Over the middle, one-handed grab, nearly pulled in there by Haberman. Heath Haberman ran a great route right up the seam, right up the hash.
It's a tremendous throw, Larry. It would have been a great catch. The coverage was good, though. I mean, you'll see right up the middle on the seam, Ehlers tries to find him. You can't throw it a whole lot better. You can't defend it a whole lot better. It just would have been a great catch,
yeah,
by Haberman. Now this circus of punting into the wind.
Cooper Guerin in there.
You almost want to soccer style it low if you can, but if you're not used to doing that.
Guerin gets it away. Not a bad kick into the wind, but it's going to provide terrific field position for the UTAN Chieftains. They will be at the 40-yard line of the Broncos with 56 seconds to go here in quarter number one.
25, 26-yard punt. It's not terrible, believe it or not, into this
in the wind.
I mean, those flags are stiff on the north side.
Get out of the field, Deshaun.
Guys, it's interesting, though, the way the wind plays in this stadium. If you look at the top of the goalpost, there really isn't a lot of wind at field level. It's just when that ball gets high up in the air when it gets caught up. So like Matt said, if you could have just a low two-iron Matt Davidson tee shot, you'd be in good luck there with your punts today.
That's right. A little stinger, Sean. How are the lips, Sean? They're kind of cold.
What a hit from that backside of the play. Caleb Cass there once again. That is his 10th sack of the season.
He is a beast off the right side of the defense. UTAN tries to go up top after throwing the interception. They said, we're going to go right back to the air. And Caleb Cass just buries Hendricks in the backfield.
So brings up second down and 18. A loss of 8 on that sack. Tripped up is Ethan Abraham on the carry, so no gain there. And what started as terrific field position and a great opportunity, suddenly the Broncos have an opportunity to hold.
This would be big. End of the quarter, we're gonna flip sides. Centennial's defense has stepped up with these short fields UTAN's been given.
No score through one quarter of play. Great defensive play on both sides. We'll be back at Memorial Stadium in just a moment on NET Sports.
Head trauma and concussion risk minimization is a priority of the NSAA. When in doubt, sit them out.
Some common symptoms of concussions are dizziness, confusion, and nausea.
The NSAA requires coaches in all sports to take a concussion course annually. For more information regarding concussion management and return to play protocol, visit our website, nsaahome.org. When in doubt, sit them out.
Coverage of the 2017 NSAA High School Football Championships on NET is made possible in part by Nebraska Public Power District, Nebraska Soybean Board, Education Quest, Methodist College, Constellation, and Aurora Cooperative. A big thank you to all of our sponsors who help us bring you the best high school athletes from across the state. We could not do it without your support. Back at Memorial Stadium in the D2 or C2 state championship game between UTAN and Centennial. No score after the first 12 minutes. Chieftains with the ball, and Matt Davidson, they had a great opportunity. It still do, but this is gonna be difficult on a long third down and 18 into the wind.
Yeah, they faced one of these before and just ran a simple option play. It didn't work. Into the wind here, even bigger challenge.
Not much there. Is in there quickly is Tyler Perry tugging at the jersey and getting the tackle. Fourth down.
Safe play, playing field position. Try to punt it down there, see if they can pin Centennial's offense inside the red zone.
Minicucci punts it away. Fair catch called for and taken to the 13-yard line, and a nice job to go get that one by Reese Foreman. So kind of a quiet start here for both of these teams offensively. We've seen some great defensive plays early.
Yeah, it was a close game before, and we saw in the first game today, you know, there's some jitters early in a game, and teams are feeling each other out a little bit, and coaches maybe a little bit more conservative, trying to just kind of get their way into the game. Well, now you're in the second quarter, And maybe it's worn off a little bit that you're actually in Memorial Stadium. Now let's see if there's some plays made. So far, the defenses have been really good.
From the 13-yard line, first and 10 for the Broncos. Ellers hands it off right into the teeth of that defense. Colton Feast was there again, along with Brett Hyerts.
Yeah, Feast on that right side that time makes you maybe want to go to the left side of the defense.
Right.
I mean, he is tough. You see Ellers tries to ride him through the hole there, maybe should have kept it, but Feast is a beast.
He's tough to run at, he's tough to run away from. Probably try to just option off him and maybe take him out of a play.
Yeah, sometimes you could take the strategy of trying to run it at them with...
How'd that work? Nice pass over the middle, incomplete, intended for Foreman. Thought he had it right through the fingertips on a terrific ball, terrific pass by Ellers.
Yeah, should have been caught. Would have been a good catch. There was traffic. Maybe thought he was going to get popped. But Foreman knows he probably should have caught that one. That would have been a big gain out past the 30-yard line. Ellers, boom. Yeah, a little behind him. Not a perfect throw.
Third down and 10. Ellers back to pass again. Looks like he's tried to set up a screen. Continues to drop. Finds his man over the middle. Complete to Hirschfeld. Hirschfeld still on his feet out to near the 30-yard line, where he's piled up 48th reception of the season for the leading receiver for these Broncos, Jackson Hirschfeld.
Hirschfeld just ran a 15-yard dig route, goes up the field, finds a hole right in the middle of the defense. Ellers finds him. Nice throw and catch for a first down.
One more look here. Gain of 16 on that last play. Ellers fumbles and falls right back on top of it. Second fumble for the Broncos, and second time they've gotten on top of their own fumble.
Could this be another drive that stalled because of a fumble?
Yeah.
Unfortunate here. Keeps it, not nowhere to go really anyway. He's going to get tackled, but nearly disastrous as the ball hits the turf. But watch it bounce right up to him. Boom, that's a lucky bounce.
Carrying that in one hand, too, when he got out there on the edge. Let's go down to the field to Sean.
Yeah, guys, after that fumble, Coach Krycek here on the UTAN sideline said, guys, they're getting lucky. We're going to get one of these eventually. And he's right. A pretty fortunate bounce right there for Centennial to get the ball back.
Ellers with the throw just over the head of Heath Haberman.
On a third and 15, so they're going to be forced to punt, too. Back and forth, punt after punt.
Just that much too tall. So Garrett in there to punt it away. Cooper Garrett averages 31.7. Wait a minute, third and 15.
Oh, that was just third. Sorry, they had already changed it from the last down.
That's right, they did. Third and 15. Over the middle, skipped in there, I believe. Are they going to see he caught it?
He's short of the first down, but he caught it, I believe.
So just a couple of yards, maybe 1 yard shy at the 38. They need the 39 for the first. One more look.
Tell you what, that chain gang is quick. And yes.
That's a good catch.
Looks like a good catch, and they're lining up to go for it on fourth down and one. Oh, boy.
They had the hard count set, and Grant Fellhofer fell for his own team's hard count. That'll back him up 5 yards and lead to a punt.
That was going to be
a dead ball. False start on offense. Still fourth down.
That was going to be a risky move by Centennial.
You think they were going to go for
I
it?
I think they maybe were. I would assume that's why he jumped to block somebody, because he couldn't wait to block somebody. I think they were going to go for it. Instead, now they're going to have to punt it.
Guaranteed to punt it away. Low line drive. We'll take a roll. down to about the 30-yard line and then out of bounds. And that's where it will be once again the Chieftains' ball here in the second quarter of this C2 championship game. Well, now it's time for our NSAA championship trivia. You can be the first person to email the correct answer to sports@netnebraska.org, and you'll win an NET Sports Crew t-shirt size extra large. So here's our trivia question. Who holds the NSAA Class C2 and NSAA All-Class record of most touchdown passes in a game? Once again, NSAA C2 and All-Class record for most touchdown passes in a game. First correct email to sports@netnebraska.org wins the NET Sports Crew t-shirt. And remember, just one winner per household during the 2017 state championships.
Interesting. I think I might have had a piece of that at one point, Larry Putney, but all these passing offenses now, I'll tell you, they just, no more records for Davison.
It has to be depressing for you.
I'll tell you. Especially on this field. Menicucci there off the left side gets a couple. Now they give him just one. This is the first one to a point today. Could be in good shape. Both defenses playing well so far.
Menicucci with the nifty little run. Gets skinny in the hole and slides through there out to the 35-yard line. That'll bring up a third down and three.
Yeah, nifty run this time. Not much there, and they're going to try to go quick with a little pace.
Here's the hurry up on third down and three. They'll peek over to the sideline. Will Griffin Hendricks. Hard count.
Hard count.
Yep.
Good job by Centennial sitting in there.
Toss to Menicucci. Cuts it back up to about, probably going to be about a yard short. That went to the 37, knee to the 38.
Now do they go for it? Into the wind, they know, might not get a lot out of a punt. Maybe you're thinking go for it here on your own 37-yard line.
Or maybe you're not.
Nope. They're going to punt it. I thought he had a chance to maybe get there, Larry, but nice job getting off the block by Haberman and getting a piece of him.
Yeah, and I think when Menicucci cut back, he ran right into Lucas Powell, who was trying to take the defender out of the play. Slowed him up a bit. So kick is away from Menicucci. Fair catch called for right at the 30 by Foreman.
Pretty good punt.
6:50 to go here, second quarter. Still no score. And a battle of two teams very familiar with each other. They've played once already this year, four times in the last 15 months, as we said off the top. And I think we're seeing the results of that.
No question. I mean, they have watched film, yeah. And they've watched film, they've watched film in the last week. And both coaches now just wondering, is there some way that I can find an advantage? Maybe it's one big player, one big missed tackle that turns this game completely. Wide open down the sideline.
Got him out there, pulled in and caught. Great toss to Hirschfeld for a first down and a big play inside of Chieftain territory. Completion by Ellers, great throw.
Ellers threw that one a long way, Larry. All the way down the left side of the sideline, Hirschfeld. Watch Ellers, he just rears back, throws it as hard as he can. The safety's late getting there. It was a straight go route. Good throw and catch.
So that'll flip the field here in the second quarter. 38-yard completion to Hirschfeld. First down and 10. Now ball at the 32-yard line. Deepest penetration of the game for the Broncos. On the option to the right. And a flag on the play. Nice job of coming off the block and making a big tackle for the Chieftains.
Pretty good hit. Gavin Avery thought he had a little lane, but this is going to be an illegal chop block on Centennial.
Preston.
Right in the middle of the line. And this is going to move him back, way back.
Preston Pierce on that last hit.
Still sorting this thing out. Mr. White Hat is mic'd. And here we go.
We're blocking below the waist. 72 blue. We're going to reflect down.
Infraction called on Garrett Fellhofer.
Yeah, Fellhofer went low. Maybe hit a guy who was engaged with another player. But first and 25 now, that is a drive killer.
Tries to scramble out of trouble. Two or three around him, and finally sneaks forward before he's dropped down. And the play by Jaden Stewart.
Ellers. Looked like he was going to lose about 5 yards. Was able to get away just enough to get it back near the line of scrimmage.
This front five of the Chieftains. Two DNs, two tackles, nose tackle. Has been very active and put a lot of pressure here early on Wyatt Ellers. Ellers back to throw, looking downfield. Now finally gets some pressure. They were giving him some time. He's going to be drugged down from behind. Colton Feast once again with a terrific play.
Man, he can really run for how big he is. I mean, Feast is a guy, they have him listed 6'3", 230. And he looks like he can really move. Watch him chase him down from behind. Good player.
That's a great play by Feast. His head coach Dan Krychek said he's the best player in Class C2. Maybe one of the best in the state. Never stops, has a motor that doesn't stop. He All-State in football, All-State in basketball as a junior. Undecided on what he wants to do at the next level, but certainly has opportunities. Wide open over the middle and dropped. Freeman had a free go at it and a first down on a great toss from Ellers and could not reel it in.
Man, right in the seam. It was like Foreman thought he was going to get hit. Larry, you never know. Maybe he looked back and lost it somehow, but would have been a huge play down around the 10-yard line. Instead, they're going to be forced to punt it with 4:42 to go. Ball's on the left hash. They just ran him right in the middle of the zone, right down the seam. Can't throw much better.
A low punt picked up by Minicucci, who came up to get it. Most of the defenders had gone by him. Check that. That was not Minicucci. It was Preston Pierce who picked that up and took off. Nice heads-up play by Pierce.
Smart play. Smart play by Pierce. He is not the punt returner. But he saw that it was short. He came up. Nobody around him, so he says, hey, I'll take it. Probably saved him 15 yards of field position. Smart.
4:33 before half here in Lincoln. We're at Memorial Stadium along with Matt Davison. I'm Larry Putney. Sean Callahan is down on the field. Glad you could join us for this Class C2 state championship game between UTAN and Centennial. No score. 4:33 to go. Tries the screen out of the backfield, but nothing there. Good defense by the Broncos.
We've seen it all day. Neither offense doing a whole lot. Centennial with 100 yards of offense. UTAN, about 19 yards of total offense for UTAN in the first half so far. And remember, he had the one huge play from Centennial. They have 100 yards on the day, but one play got him 38.
Second down, 13. Minicucci tried the corner. Nice play from the backside by Max Toms. And Toms with the tackle. That's 65 tackles on the year for Toms.
Third and 13 into the breeze. Not where you want to be as UTAN's offense. Try to pull Feast around from right to left. Just too many hats, too many guys in blue for Minicucci to find anywhere to go.
Rolling to his right and hands it off inside, and that is going nowhere. Good awareness by the interior line as Quinn Butsky, first time we've called his name, along with Cooper Taylor, both were there.
Try a little sprint out draw. Try to get a lot of flow from the defense from left to right and try to just sneak Minicucci between those D linemen. Sprint out with a draw back the other direction. Goes nowhere, and Centennial uses a timeout to try to preserve some time, make UTAN punt it into the wind.
Fourth down and 19, 2:56 to go. Hey, I want to remind you this Wednesday on NAT World, Big Red Wrap-Up moves to a special time due to these high school football championships. Join Andy Kendi, who will be in for Kevin Kugler, Blake Lawrence, Sean Callahan as they recap the Penn State game and look ahead to Friday's game against Iowa with special guest Aaron Sorensen from landof10.com. You don't want to miss Big Red Wrap-Up on Wednesday on NET World, 7 Central, and again at 10 p.m. on NET. So fourth down and long. Just over 3 minutes remaining before halftime. Minicucci in there to punt it away. Back deep for Centennial, Reese Foreman. Minicucci squibs it along. Foreman decides to grab it, save some field position, but also got a good pop there out of it. But a nice job, takes it at the 41.
Yeah, it was a nice play by Foreman. But he took a nice shot there from Clayton Nelson, who hit him right when he got the ball. It was a risky play by Foreman to even field that one. And I think Nelson might have hurt himself a little bit with that hit. He's still walking around a little gingerly. Yeah, bang, bang play. Ball arrives and Nelson hit him.
Broncos offense back on the field now. Here is Wyatt Ehlers to throw. Breaks one tackle.
It'll stop the clock over on the sideline. 2:50 to go in the half. I don't know if, you know, time could become an issue. Right now, it's really not. You have two timeouts left if you're Centennial. And for the most part, you haven't moved the ball very well. So I guess it could take a few plays to work your way down the field if it's going to happen.
Three receivers to the top. And once again, guess who's there? Colton Feast.
Great play. Hit him and brought him down right where he hit him. No forward progress. Feast, we've said it, big, strong kid, grabs him and throws him down in the backfield.
There is not a lot of yak when Colton Feast is tackling you. Nice completion. Good for a first down to Jackson Hirschfeld.
Hirschfeld's made a few plays today. Nice throw there. Now let's see if they try to go quick, if it actually gives them some rhythm. Larry, maybe trying to go quick with some tempo will give UTAN's defense some issues and might give Centennial a little more energy.
Over the middle, coming back for it. And incomplete, no flag on the play, intended for Max Tomes.
Yeah, good no call, I think. I mean, he's in the seam. Ball was underthrown a little bit. Sometimes you'll get the call because the defender runs into the wide receiver, but to me there, a good no call.
Brings up second down and 10.
At the 5-yard line, the guy in the blue.
Ehlers rose to his right, a flag and a shove in the back, so we'll have a block in the back, and this is going to come back. It'll be second down and 20 upcoming, or plus, after the flag.
Yeah, it's one of those that everybody in the stadium, pretty much, was looking at that part of the field, right near the ball. Usually, you're going to get caught.
Nice.
get an announcement here. I'll almost guarantee you. In just a little bit.
Referee Felix Mitchell and his crew, Bob McLaughlin, Troy Lanham, John Robinson.
Well, block in the back. Number 57, blue. Second down.
A little chilly out there for Felix, isn't it?
Well, yeah, they want to get it right.
That's right.
Let's say deliberate.
I was blaming it on the weather. It's a little cold out there. Everything slows down a little bit.
Yeah, I mean, I saw it was number 57.
Yeah.
15 yards, moving back.
Second down and 32. Hand off to Gavin Avery. It's about seven of those back.
UTAN has all three timeouts. I doubt they use them. I think at this point, both teams are probably going to be happy to just go in at zeros. Centennial with a third and 20 bunt, a bunch over 20. 20
third and 20 bunch.
24, 25 yards. They're going to be fine, I think, using the clock here and probably punting it away. I don't think UTAN's going to use their timeouts. Has there ever been a state final go to overtime with zeros?
I don't believe so.
Think about it.
Yeah, we'll have to look that up.
Both defenses playing well.
Well, a nice play again. That's Preston Pierce. Called his name a few times here in this first half. Looked like Ehlers might have some room, and Pierce closed quickly.
Yeah, good tackle in the open field. About 25 seconds difference between the play clock and the game clock. They might even take a penalty here. I'm not worried about it.
So Grant in there to kick it away. He's got an average of 31 on the year. Long of 57. This will have a wind at his back. And we do have the flag. Did not get the snap off in time. Delay of game. That'll back him up five more yards.
Yeah, just used as much clock as they could. Now snap it.
We have a dead ball. Delay on blue. Fourth down.
They'll be able to snap it, punt it. Shouldn't be much time left for UTAN here at the end of the second quarter.
Over the head, could be trouble. Try to get it off, and he does. That's going to save him about 40 yards in field position. Nice job by Garen to drag that, run it down, and get that putt off.
I mean, that was very, very near disaster. If he's not able to pick that thing up clean,
yeah.
Or UTAN nearly blocked it as well.
We're going to talk the NSAA Volleyball Championships here at halftime. We'll also talk about making the game safer and what's being done in Omaha. And we'll have a look at highlights and statistics from our first half of play here in Lincoln.
A lot of tackling going to go on in those highlights, I think.
And another flag.
False start.
Back in the play.
A little sloppy here late.
We have a dead ball. False start on white. First down.
Probably just one play here at the end of the second quarter. We'll get us to the half.
Give to Minicucci, leans forward down to the out to the 45-yard line, and that will do it, barring a timeout, and we don't get one. So that is our first half of play, no score here in this Class C2 state championship. The Chieftains of UTAN came in at 9-3. Broncos of Centennial unbeaten at 12-0. Second meeting of the year for these two teams. First one was won by Centennial. Sean Callahan down in the field. We'll have comments from the coach here in just a moment.
Halftime adjustments are going to be huge. Which team can maybe come up with something offensively that is going to give these defenses issues? Not much success on either side.
Let's get out on the field with Sean.
Well, guys, I'm with Coach Klemitzky here. You guys, 0-0, kind of a stalemate. What's it going to take to break this game open, Coach?
Our offense needs to get going. We did some decent stuff in the run game really early, but haven't been very consistent offensively. We've dropped three very big passes, so we got to get our offense going. I think our defense has settled in really well, especially with Manicucci in the backfield, so we got to get our offense going.
With the win today, how big will this field position and special teams be here in the second half?
Yeah, I think it'll continue to be big. Like I said, we had some good balls in the first half, even with the win, that we weren't able to get a hold of. So field position and the small things in the second half.
Well, Coach, best of luck with your team here in the second half.
Thanks a lot.
All right, guys, thanks.
All right, thanks very much. Sean, we're at halftime. No score between the Chieftains and Broncos. C2 title. We'll be back in just a moment here in Lincoln.
Whether it's spring planting, fall harvesting, or just a drive across the state, soy biodiesel helps a diesel-powered engine operate in a demanding job. Soybean oil from Nebraska soybeans makes biodiesel a renewable fuel that's also environmentally responsible. The Soybean Checkoff plays a major role in supporting the use and availability of biodiesel. The Nebraska Soybean Board, growing opportunity from the ground up.
High school's almost over. What's next? I mean, what are my choices? I want to find something I love, so I can make a life for myself. And then I can give back. So, how do I get there?
Take the next step with Education Quest College Planning Services by visiting educationquest.org.
You're watching NET Television.
Next time on Finding Your Roots.
Oh my God, this
Gabby
is crazy.
Hoffman.
I have at times felt very, very lost.
And Taya Leone.
Who's that?
That's your grandma.
Wow. Gosh.
On the next Finding Your Roots.
Tonight on NET World.
Of the 2017 NSAA High School Football Championships on NET is made possible in part by Nebraska Public Power District, Nebraska Soybean Board, Education Quest, Methodist College, Constellation, and Aurora Cooperative. A big thank you to all of our sponsors who help us bring you the best high school athletes from across the state. We could not do it without your support. Back in Lincoln at halftime of the Class C2 State Championship, we have no score between UTAN and Centennial. Joined now by Assistant Director of the NSAA, Jen Schwartz, who's responsible for volleyball and another terrific year of volleyball here in the capital city for the state championships. Talk about how things went.
Things went well. Obviously, it was a great day of volleyball. We crowned six champions in one day, which is a marathon, but oh, it was amazing. We had two schools that had never won a championship before, so that was Wahoo and Superior, and then we had two other schools that won their third straight title, Scott Catholic and Johnson Brock, and then of course we had Omaha Marion and Exeter Milligan, which are tournament regulars.
Level of volleyball, the quality of volleyball in the state, I think we talk about this every year, but it's remarkable. The individuals from the high school level who go on to play at the next level, just the quality in the state.
Oh, absolutely. And that's obviously attributed to our fantastic high school coaches, obviously the training that the girls receive, and even the coaches. I mean, we have some superior volleyball in our state.
Feedback from playing at Devaney?
Oh, fantastic. Yeah. You can feel the energy in the building just by being there. So we really appreciate, obviously, John giving up the facility and letting the high school girls be there. That's a tremendous opportunity for them.
So talk about officiating at the high school level.
Well, actually, the championship was amazing. It was kind of hard on Saturday, as we're showing the clips here. There are times when the viewers at home and actually the spectators in the arena, because of the big screen, could see the replays.
Yeah.
And we had officials down on the court. In high school, we don't get to use video replay. And so there were several times that I felt bad for the referees, because everybody could see what was happening in slow motion. And obviously their job is to make a decision in real time, and overwhelmingly they got the calls right. So appreciate all their efforts, as I think high school officiating in volleyball is pretty good across the state.
Yeah, it's let's talk about the champs from this year. Why don't we take a look at those who won state titles?
Absolutely. As we mentioned earlier, two of the schools, this was their first championship ever for their school, in C1, Wahoo, and in C2, Superior. Obviously, Class A, Omaha Marion won their match. Omaha Scott Catholic in Class B, their third straight championship. Johnson Brock in D1, which was their third straight championship. And then rounding out the classes in D2, Exeter Milligan.
And I would just say again, the opportunity to see players who are moving on to the next level, and not just the next level to play, because there are several of those across all classes, but to see those who are really moving to the highest level next year. And we had that across classes. In Class A, we had a Nebraska recruit all the way down to Class D. We had, you know, an individual who's going on to play at the university.
Absolutely. I can't say enough about high school girls volleyball in Nebraska. I've had the opportunity to go to a couple other states and see their championships. Ours is pretty special.
Yeah. So what's ahead for volleyball?
What's ahead? Well, actually, this last year, the membership moved to the season up, voted to move the season up by a week. And now then in January, the membership's going to take a look at whether or not we move the back end of the season up a week. So there's an opportunity that state volleyball with districts and everything will move up a week. So we would actually give the girls in volleyball an extra week off before the winter sports season starts. Obviously, the membership will have to vote on that, and we'll see how it goes. But we're not talking probably until maybe 2019 that we would make that change.
Well, congratulations on another terrific state tournament.
Thanks, Larry.
Yeah.
Appreciate everything that NET does. Oh. I know it's a lot of effort, a lot of hours, but it's amazing what
you
do for us.
Yep, a lot of fun. That's Jennifer Schwartz, who's assistant director of the NSAA, talking high school volleyball in the state of Nebraska. When we come back, statistic and highlights right here on NET.
For me, asking why is just getting started.
It's more than an activity. It's me doing what I love.
I'm not a stereotype. When I rewrite the rules, things get better.
I know that all these experiences matter.
These moments will help me become something more.
Little things always lead to something bigger.
Do it.
Track it.
Earn it.
What you're doing now will help you get scholarships later. Find resources from Education Quest at trackyoursuccess.org.
With the Aurora Cooperative, you have a trusted partner who looks well beyond the horizon. We're putting our owner's equity to work every day by anticipating what you'll need tomorrow, creating what's next for your farm, a portfolio of innovation that supports every aspect of your operation, and an unwavering commitment to your success, however you measure it.
My farm, my cooperative, my future.
The Aurora Cooperative.
Earning my shield
means... It means I'm always moving forward.
Never stopping, always learning.
It means rising to the challenge of my ambition.
Earning my shield means having the confidence to hold my own with anyone from anywhere.
It means more opportunities for me and my children.
Earning my shield
means it's never too early or late to set goals. What does it mean to earn your shield? I found out it don't.
You're watching NET Television.
Live streaming for the NSAA State High School Football Championships is also available at the NET website and on the free NET Nebraska app.
Welcome back to Memorial Stadium in Lincoln. We're at halftime of this Class C2 State Championship. You know, safety In the game of football has been a hot topic lately, especially in the high school ranks within the state of Nebraska. And time now to check in on how schools in Omaha are gearing up to help protect their student athletes.
I think it's a great combination of safe equipment and technology to provide ways to prevent concussions and information on how to help recover from a concussion.
New data tracking football helmets have emerged in the Omaha area this fall. The helmets are designed to assess when a player has sustained a hard hit.
The helmet does not diagnose a concussion. The helmet does not prevent a concussion, but it's another tool in our toolbox that our coaches and our athletic trainers have to truly take data and assess the safety and well-being of our kids.
Separate donations made these helmets possible for all 7 Omaha Public Schools, Creighton Prep, and Bellevue East and West.
I think that speaks volumes to their generosity and the big picture that they truly care about all kids. To have this for every single one of our high school football players is amazing.
But how do these high-tech helmets work? Inside each helmet are 5 sensors measuring impacts. Those sensors send an alert to a handheld device if the player has received an impact that is severe.
Because each helmet is registered to their name and their jersey number, so it pops up. We know exactly to go over to them, check on them, make sure they're okay. I mean, the preventative measures that it gives us, because you can't see everybody, so those things are huge, making sure. And if I was a parent, I'd love it because it would let me know that my son's safety from head injury is always being monitored and looked at.
What I'm excited about is coaches receive data that will truly help them reteach proper fundamentals of tackling and blocking. They can receive data that would show, hey, when we do this one drill, we have more alerts during this particular drill. Maybe we need to change something up with that. To be proactive, to kind of shape how our coaches structure practice, the kind of drills that they're doing, and to talk with individuals that perhaps are demonstrating poor fundamentals, they can rectify that. So it's truly an amazing tool. The response was very positive and it was overwhelming. I think the parents, they feel a little bit more at ease knowing that our kids are in the top of the line equipment that can help them be safe and provide information that, you know, that our coaches and trainers can monitor to keep them safe.
I don't think it'll ever be a non-factor, concussions, but I think it's making it safer and safer for parents to allow their kids to play it. Our community wants to see our kids be safe and do well, and I think that was a great message to send. We are extremely thankful for it, and parents are thankful that somebody would donate that amount of money to make sure their son's well-being is being looked after.
Yeah, terrific job by technology and innovation and the progress that we're making on keeping our kids safe. We're at halftime of the Class C2 title. No score here in Lincoln.
The values that Methodists bring is family.
It's important going through school that you're not just a number, that you're a face and that you're a name to a teacher. And so I loved the small class sizes.
What it means to me is that I found my foundation where I can build on my passion and I can embrace something new in my life. It is a place where I know that I'm supposed to be.
Join us for the next Big Red Wrap-Up. This week, co-host Sean Callahan will help recap the Penn State game with special guest Aaron Sorensen from Land of 10. Big Red Wrap-Up, Wednesday at 7 Central on NET World and again at 10 Central on NET.
Hi, I'm Perry Stoner. Sports fans tell us that NET brings Nebraska together through coverage of high school and college athletics. Contributions from hundreds of Sports Partners Club members make possible more than 200 hours of sports throughout the year. Members receive invitations to special events like tailgates with sports notables and live productions. You can join the Sports Partners Club by visiting netnebraska.org. Sports partners like you put the action in NET sports. Thank you.
Coverage of the 2017 NSAA High School Football Championships on NET is made possible in part by Nebraska Public Power District, Nebraska Soybean Board, Education Quest, Methodist College, Constellation, and Aurora Cooperative. A big thank you to all of our sponsors who help us bring you the best high school athletes from across the state. We could not do it without your support. U10 0, Centennial 0 here at the halftime of the C2 title game at Memorial Stadium in Lincoln. Let's take a look at the first half highlights to begin with, and then we'll get to the stats.
Yeah, there weren't a lot of offensive highlights, a lot of defensive highlights. Feast was fantastic on the defensive side for UTAN. Ehlers was able to get it going a little bit at times on the offensive side, but it was mostly defense all day long. Caleb Cast, we know, can play on that side of the ball. He did a great job. Feast did a great job. That play was made by Jaden Stewart for UTAN. Just not a lot doing. Centennial had a couple opportunities through the air, and it didn't work out. On this one, it was Foreman going up and making a nice interception down inside the 10-yard line for Centennial when it looked like UTAN might have had something going in the first half. Minicucci is the man for UTAN, and he just never really got going in that first half. 13 carries, 29 yards for Minicucci. And then near the end of the half, when Centennial was trying to put a drive together, Pierce made a big play.
Let's go down to the field to Sean.
Guys, I'm with Coach Krychek here for UTAN. What'd you tell your team here? It's kind of a stalemate game where really one mistake could really flip this game either way.
Yeah, we're playing pretty good defense. They're playing really good defense. It's just going to come down to, you know, maybe breaking a play here or there. And, field position is going to be big with the wind. Trying to stay ahead on down and distance so we don't get in a bad situation where they can just send everybody on us. And, they're putting 9 guys in the box. So if we could just get by that first layer, I think we'll be all right. But they're a pretty good team over there.
Well, Coach, here, best of luck here in the second half.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
Thanks to head coach Dan Krychek for just spending a couple of minutes here as we get ready for quarter number 3 out of the halftime locker room, 0-0. Take a look at the statistics and you'll see the total yards heavily weighted towards Centennial, but the one that matters is the 0-0 on the scoreboard.
That's right. I mean, even 125 yards obviously isn't what Centennial is looking for. And they got 38 yards on one play on the big play down the field to Hirschfeld. So not a lot going on for either offense right now. And Sean said it right there too. It could be one play. Maybe it's a special teams play. It's either a big offensive play or maybe it's a blunder. Maybe it's a fumble pick six or a pick up a fumble, run it in for 6, something like that, that really changes this game.
So there is Evan Klinetsky with his players. Twelve and 0 on the year. Head coach Dan Krychek, 6th season overall. Brought his team back from that difficult start at 0-3 to make it all the way here to Memorial Stadium. So the Broncos will kick it off here to start this second half of play. It will be the Chieftains who will have the first offensive possession. It's Caleb Cast to kick it away. There's a look at Brylan Minicucci, 5'10 sophomore. Back to return the kick along with Chase Purchill.
And the entire Tom Osborne field covered in shade pretty much now. So temperature has probably dropped in the last half an hour. Maybe the wind will start to go down as evening starts to set in, but it's gonna be chilly down there. We've seen a bunch of fumbles today in both games.
Oh. Caleb cast out to kick it away. Little squib kick through there. It'll be taken at the 29-yard line. A return out to the 40. A return by Ethan Abraham. And the Chieftains have the first possession.
Yeah, good field position for UTAN. It's going to be interesting to me to see both of these offenses in their first series, Larry. See what they talked about at halftime. See if there's anything that one of the coaches came up with that's going to be different. Something that'll give issue to one of these defenses. Because right now, you know, both teams were scouted well coming into this thing.
So out of the eye, here's Minicucci at the top. He gets the carry. Nice trap. Minicucci with a good carry on first down of 10 yards, one of his better runs of the day.
No question. They'd go into the boundary, short side of the field. Quick hitter. A couple of nice blocks on the right side, and they're going to give him 9.5 yards. Yeah. So second just and a foot.
Same play the other way. Inside of Bronco territory.
Yeah, they bring Colton Feast from right to left. Across the line, gets a nice block. He's a good guy to follow through a hole. And Minicucci gets a first down, and they're in Centennial territory. A nice block from Feast.
First down and 10, the first down of the second half for the Chieftains. Minicucci at the top of the eye again. They give to the fullback. And that's Abraham with the carry. Abraham with a gain of about 3 yards.
So they have a little something going now. A little rhythm to the offense. They get a first down. Nice positive play on first. Not a great play, but you get three.
Much there for Minicucci. It's going to bring up third down, maybe a yard for Minicucci, third and 5.
Yeah, they didn't give him much. Maybe a yard, yard and a half. Looked like it was going to be better than that. Look at that big right hand stuck out there by Caleb Cast. And that one big arm was able to slow him down enough that the pursuit came.
Third down and 4, now rolling to his left. Had a man out there, could not find him. Intended receiver was Chase Purchill.
Tough throw. Quarterback's running to his left, right-handed quarterback. Has to try to get square to the line of scrimmage and wasn't really very close with that pass attempt. So it's going to be a punt for UTAN. Not ideal, but they have gained field position here and should be able to. They're going to try to draw him off. I can't believe they would go for it here with the score tied at 0.
Fourth down and 4.
Whoa.
And they go. Quick toss out. Step up. First down. What a play. Ooh, very close to a first down. Thought he was through there. Maybe not. He might be a half yard short.
He's short, Larry. I think he's short. That was a play we hadn't seen yet and a risk taken by UTAN. I like being aggressive. It was a great play and a play that looked like it was going to get there for a first down, but I think he's about a half ball short, and it's going to turn over on downs to Centennial.
First drive in the books of the second quarter. We'll be back with the second half. We'll be back here in Lincoln.
Not just on the good days. Not just on the challenging ones. Not just during business hours or when relaxing, but always. For the past 125 years, Farmers Mutual of Nebraska, always alongside you.
The Nebraska Chiropractic Physicians Association is pleased to sponsor the NSAA Academic All-State Award Program, recognizing students and athletes who shine in the classroom and on the field. This statewide program recognizes academic excellence, leadership, and athletic achievement in over 20 high school sports and activities. We honor these exceptional students and all of the teachers, coaches, and parents who have mentored them. Together, we can continue to make Nebraska a great place to live, learn, and play.
Breezy afternoon here in Lincoln, and a chilly one as well, as no score here in this C2 title game. Risky move there on fourth down for the Chieftains. Let's see if it pays off, if they can hold Centennial here, maybe just in one first down or less.
Yeah, I think he was trying to send a message there. Hey, it's fourth down and five. I mean, it wasn't fourth and one or fourth and two. It was fourth and five. And it was a well-designed play. And really, Minicucci ran into his own man, Lehi, or he probably gets it.
The other way. Boy, great job of getting off the block. And we're going to have a flag, and that will be a hold on the Broncos. Even though, once again, Preston Pierce got off that block and made a play.
I think it was Hirschfeld out there. This will just take a minute or so to sort through. We'll get the announcement. But I think they're going to get a hold on Hirschfeld.
Yep, there it is. So Felix Mitchell straightens it out down there. They'll march it off 10 yards, brings up second down and 18. It was fairly apparent right away as the receiver was out there blocking on the corner, and Preston Pierce was able to shake loose and make a play. Eller's back in the shotgun. Avery to his right, fakes the give to him. Nice grab, can he break a tackle? That had an opportunity there as Max Tomes with the catch.
Yeah, that was a good tackle, Larry. Tomes with the catch, gets upfield quickly and has a full head of steam. And if that tackle is not made by Nelson, he might not be caught and it could be 6 points. Open field tackle right here. Good job wrapping up, getting him to the ground.
So third down, and they're going to call it 11, maybe a long 10. Eller's back again, no pressure, over the middle. Tipped away, nice play defensively by Chase Purchill to get the hand on it. Chase, I think, thought, maybe I should have gone up and got that one. Yeah, nice play defensively.
They rushed just three there, dropped eight. They had three guys blocking Feast on the right side. Look at that, running back, a guard, and a tackle. Three guys blocking Feast. So eight guys back in coverage, and they end up knocking it away.
Ooh, that's a helmet hitting the turf hard here at Memorial Stadium. That does not feel good.
Oh, they fake it.
Faked.
My
right
goodness.
Up the middle. Is he going to get it? No, he'll come up short. Ball is out. Won't matter. It's turned over, and the Chieftains get it back. That was an awful long fourth down. Looked like he had an opportunity early, but a terrific job of hustling up by Purchill and making a play. One more look.
Yeah, you know, it's fourth down and 10, and you think maybe it was, I wonder if it was called or not, or if they told him, hey, if you think it's there, give it a shot. And if, was it Baltrip? Who was that? Tried to run it. No?
It was Guerin.
Guerin. Yep. And you wonder if it was called or not.
Stepping through, Minicucci. Let's go down to the field, Deshaun.
Guys, on that fumble there at the end, too, it was almost intentional. I think he knew he was short, and he tried to roll the ball forward on that fumble. So I don't even know if it would have counted if that fumble would have rolled across the line to gain, and they would have recovered. Because I believe you can't advance a first down on fourth down like that with a fumble.
Right. Right, and it did look like he tried to do it on purpose. I guess, hey, Maybe you can try get away with it.
Try something.
Until the other team grabs it and runs it in. Right. Nice.
Right in the hole in the pot by the Tyler Perry linebacker.
Great hit. So we've seen a fourth down stuffed by Centennial, then a fake punt that UTAN was able to stop. And now good field position for UTAN again. And they're faced with a third and long. These linemen on both sides, you know, they're going both ways.
Right.
They're trying to block each other, and then on the other side, they're trying to get around each other. Big play here.
Great completion from Hendricks out to Purchill, and Purchill down inside the 15-yard line on a big play for the Chieftains.
Their best play of the day, not even close. Nice throw and catch. The ball is in the middle of the field. They throw it out to the left side, and a missed tackle right there by Foreman. And just one quick move from Purchill, and they're down at the 15-yard line.
Well, first down and 10 at the 15. Deepest penetration for either team in the game, and here's Minicucci. A couple of yards there, down to about the 12. We'll bring up second down. Best scoring drive for either team. 28 yards on that last play by Purchill.
Another play made there by Caleb Cast, where it looked like Minicucci had a bigger hole than that. It looked like it might be a bigger gain, but Cast able to stick an arm out and grab him.
Cast looks like he's fully engaged in No Shave November.
I still couldn't grab it. I mean,
not that anyway, right?
I couldn't grow that. Can't grow it on my head. Not a hair grower.
Yeah, we're gonna let you make that comment.
Yeah, look at that. He's a grown man.
How about that?
A grown man. Big dude, Caleb Cast, over there for Centennial. 6'3", 220 pounds. Now a big third down, Larry. Third and five at the 10. And do they kick it if they don't get it?
Yeah. Third down and five, rolling to his left is Hendricks toward the end zone, incomplete. Intended once again for Purchill, and now it is decision time. They are 0 for 1 this year in field goals, but they are 21 of 26 in PATs.
This is longer than a PAT by about 7 yards. That's the second time we've seen them roll into the left, and they haven't been able to complete it. It's been where Hendricks has just led him too far to the sideline. And they're going to use a timeout, I think. Think about this deal on fourth and five. 3-0 could win this baby with the way the defenses are playing.
Yeah, absolutely.
The question is, can you knock it through?
Right. Well, it's a good time for you to connect with us on Facebook and Twitter. You can add a comment, catch up on the latest Nebraska sports information. Just be sure to like NET Sports and Big Red Wrap-Up and join in the discussion. Use the hashtag NET Sports during these NSAA High School Football Championships on Facebook and on Twitter. Sean Callahan has something for us on the field.
Guys, you get the sense UTAN is gonna go for this. There's no sign of anybody warming up or getting ready to kick a field goal here, so my read right now is they're going for 7 here.
Fourth down and 5. Neither team has been this deep in the other team's territory all game long.
Obviously, almost play of the game right here.
30 minutes of clock time, and this is the deepest either team has been. And they're going to go for it. Hendricks under center. Rolls. He's under pressure. Can't get it away. Ball's on the ground, and it's going to be turned over, and the Broncos have it. Big play defensively as they sit the house.
Well, called what they thought was their best play to try to pick up the 5 yards. And as Hendricks went back, just nowhere really to go with it. Tried to sprint out to the right, looked like he was looking back to the left. But a big hit and a fumble, and now Centennial gets it back, going into the wind again here in the third quarter.
Well, let's see if that can provide some momentum, right? Nothing there, piled up by that defensive line led by Feast. Also yanking the ball in there was Chase Purchill. There's Blake Hutton, made a play.
Centennial right now, as you said, maybe a little momentum stopping them there.
Yeah, right.
I think they're wiping the brow right now saying, man, they almost scored. And we'll see if that gives them a little bit of a boost here, but second and 11, it didn't help on first down.
We've all seen the positive effects of that sudden change of positive momentum. Tip to the air, look out! Picked off! Down to the 5, to the 3-yard line! Intercepted by Alan Leahy! And a flag on the play. It might have been after the interception, but we'll have to wait and see.
I think it was, and this might be an illegal block, but it's still going to be UTAN football. And another chance to try to get points.
Sean, what do you have?
Guys, yeah, it was a block in the back, and it was behind the play. It really wouldn't have mattered from my vantage point. So this is going to be a big play because it's going to probably march it back 10 yards from the spot. And as we know, neither team has a kicker right now. So this is going to play big, this penalty, marching it back 10 more yards.
So I think you could hear Felix Mitchell there saying that it was a block in the back. There is the tip. Johnny on the spot is called Alan Leahy.
Yeah, that's the block in the back by Feast. So it's actually pretty costly. It would have been inside the 5-yard line, and Feast has made a boatload of plays today, but that one he pushed in the back. He knew he did it. Now you're out at the 15, and obviously no gimme to get points out of this thing.
I think it was Feast that actually tipped that as well. Minicucci tried to get the edge and does not. Nice job defensively. Once again, there's your guy, Caleb Cast.
Cast with a huge play. Losing 3 yards on the play was Minicucci.
Just when you think one team has made that big play that's going to give them the momentum and the edge and maybe turn the game, little things happen. And momentum is very fickle right now. Back to the I formation. Brylan Minicucci rolling to the right. Has a man out there. That's going to be a flag.
Had to get the left hand.
And check the route. Yep, that's going to be called on Jackson Hirschfeld, and it's going to be an automatic first down, and the Chieftains still have life.
Yeah, Hirschfeld had his left hand on Lehigh's back. Watch the left hand right here. He uses the left, jumps, goes around to knock it. Knocked the ball down, but a good call by the officials. Both officials saw it. Athletic play by Hirschfeld. And probably out on the playground, you don't get called.
Or maybe if he didn't grab with that left hand, he might have been able to get there anyway.
We have pass interference. Defense gonna be half the distance to the goal line. Replay, second down.
Sometimes that little grab, though, can provide some momentum to help you move forward and get there to get the, because he was there in time to tip the ball away. It was that left-hand pull that
good call.
Threw the flag.
Absolutely, good call. And
so ball's at the 9-yard line. It'll be first down and goal. Minicucci in the backfield. Griffin Hendricks under center. He'll toss to Minicucci, who tries to get the edge. They're giving chase. Minicucci down to the 5 or the 4. Good effort as he gets down to the 3-yard line. And now you want to be very careful because you are in a situation now where a field goal could win it. And this is like an extra point right here.
Well, At this point, you want quick hitters.
Yep.
If I'm UTAN, I don't want anything where somebody's going backwards. Centennial has proven that they can get tackles for loss. They've had a bunch of them today. It's a quick hitter with Minicucci.
And there it is. Minicucci in there for the touchdown.
You just felt the pressure building. Centennial had been playing with fire. UTAN had been playing on this side of the field pretty much the entire third quarter.
It took 32 minutes and 23 seconds, but we have points on the board here in this Class C2 title game. Minicucci dives in from two out.
Interception, turnover leads to a short field after they were just stopped on fourth down here.
Here is Blake Hutton with the extra point, and that is up, and it is good. Hutton, no problem. 7-0 lead for UTAN.
Minicucci had to earn everything today. 23 carries, 60 yards. But the biggest one was right here, a touchdown. See him lean forward. Great block. Look at Feast. Right guard. Great block by Feast. I'd follow him into the hole, into a bar fight, anything. He's a big cat, and Minicucci into the end zone.
Turnovers are the big equalizer. The turnover led to the points, and even though they have been outgained nearly 2-1, right now the scoreboard reads UTAN on top, 7-0 late in quarter number three. The Broncos will see what they can do here with this next possession. Back deep is Reese Foreman. Foreman is flanked by Guerin and Tomes.
Toe kick.
And that'll be bobbled but taken by Tomes. Slips two tackles but not a third. He'll be piled up at about the 22-yard line.
7-0. And it feels like it's even bigger than that because these offenses have struggled so much. I've been told via Twitter that the fewest points scored in a C2 championship game is 13, 1986.
Wow, that's been a while ago.
And the only OT in C2 history is 2009. I'm just going to take Tony for his word.
Nothing up the middle. Jaden Stewart is there to provide the stop. You know, Ehlers came into this game with 1,858 yards through the air, 22 touchdowns. He had rushed for another 500. And don't forget, in the first time these two met, it was late in the game. UTAN had the lead, and it was a wheel route from Ehlers to Avery with just 41 seconds to go that provided the winning score. Long way from being over here, although that Alan Leahy sack was huge, and Leahy's come up with a couple of big plays here in this third quarter. The pick and the big sack there to drop him for a loss of about 9 yards.
Yeah, just not a lot that could be done there. I mean, if you drop back to pass, Ehlers looks, and a miscommunication on the right side of the offensive line, now you're in third and 18 into the wind.
Third down and long. Ehlers goes up top. This might be picked, and it is. Or was he driven out of bounds?
Driven out of bounds.
Incomplete. Nice play. As the defender, offensive player Hirschfeld turned into a defender.
Yeah, Hirschfeld pushed him out of bounds. That would have been, he'd have come down in bounds for sure. Looks to me like Purchill would have come down. Instead, he's pushed out. So good play.
Great play.
It's probably about where they're going to end up anyway after the punt. Would have been about the 40-yard line. Let's see where they end up.
So Guerin back to kick from his own end zone. To punt it away, trailing now 7-0 and trying to do anything they can to flip the field. Here's an end-over-end kick that will not get there, and that's A nice punt by Guerin to get out of that trouble.
Great punt. 45 yards into that wind. Really well done.
On any day, at any time, the person driving next to you could be impaired. In an NET special, drugged driving, it explores the dangers and the dangerous trend of driving under the influence of illicit drugs, over-the-counter pills, or prescription medications. You don't want to miss Drugged Driving, Thursday night, 10:30 Central on NET, or you can watch it anytime at netnebraska.org/drugged-driving. Up top, got his man caught! Streaking toward the end zone, pulled down, no! Touchdown! What a play on the completion to Chase Purchill, touchdown!
In the matter of just a couple of minutes, UTAN takes complete control of this game. An interception in a short field led to the first score, then the defense gets a stop. And then up top, UTAN takes a shot. They knew they only had a couple of minutes with the wind behind them, Larry, before they get to the fourth quarter, and that would have been much more difficult. Instead, they go up top and find Purchill, and he showed some great burst and speed there to get to the end zone.
Extra point, no good. 13-0, UTAN on top. What a grab by Purchill. Here's another look, the throw from Hendricks.
What a throw. Foreman, right at the end, dives for an ankle, but Purchill's able to take it to the house. Hendricks threw that one about as far as he could, and it was perfectly thrown.
Thirteen to nothing, UTAN now on top. What a play by Chase Purchill. One play, 60 yards, 9 seconds. One play, 60 yards, 9 seconds, and now total yards are about even.
We said it. You felt like it was, you know, a big momentum play one way or another. It turned out to be the interception.
Purchill has 88 yards receiving as Foreman bobbles it. And now the Centennial is going to have to find a way to change momentum here and get something going.
Yep, drop the kickoff return and only get it to the 13-yard line. Just unraveling right now.
Two catches for Chase Purchill. He has 88 yards in that touchdown. That extends his season yardage to nearly 900 yards receiving for that young man, Chase Purchill.
Have to put a drive together now, Larry. Centennial, like you said, all momentum right now is with UTAN. They have to somehow turn things here, get a couple of first downs.
On the screen, there's Foreman, nice play. Gain of 6 or 7 yards on first down.
The good news for Centennial is it looks like the flags aren't blowing quite as hard, and at least on the goalposts, they're not moving much at all. So maybe not as big a deal going into the wind in the fourth quarter as it might have been an hour or so ago,
right? Breaks one tackle. Leans forward, has a first down. Nice second effort by Hirschfeld. Wyatt Eller's hoping to heat up here. Sometimes a sense of urgency is all you need to get you going, and it looks like maybe Centennial has found a bit of urgency here late in quarter number three. Just 1:21 to go.
Well, this is a team that hasn't lost all year, so they're looking at it saying, okay, oh, he's open.
Over the middle, picked off. What a play by Clayton Nelson.
Gone.
His fourth interception of the year down inside the 5-yard line and driven out of bounds.
What a play by Clayton Nelson.
That is a great break.
The junior playing corner I said, Larry, he was open down the seam, but Clayton Nelson came off of his man and ran in front of the receiver. Tomes was open. And he didn't even see him. And just like that, another interception. And this game has changed so much in the last 10 minutes. Unbelievable. I thought we were headed to overtime with zeros.
In the last 3 minutes. Wasn't it 4 minutes? There was no score? All of a sudden, we have a minute left of the
game
quarter.
Game time.
Right. Yeah. 49 yards on that return, and there's Minicucci down to the 2-yard line. Sean Callahan down in the field.
Guys, you can just kind of sense, not the panic necessarily, but it's a situation that Centennial really hasn't been in all year, and that was a very aggressive call to throw it deep like that, especially with the wind in their face, and that ball just kind of hung up there and allowed UTAN just to really make a play on it pretty easily.
In there for the touchdown and the keep by Hendricks. And UTAN has blown this open here late in the third.
It's just been an avalanche. One play after another. You know, you felt like Centennial was in decent shape. You see him just go off the right side here. And not a lot of resistance there from Centennial's defense. You felt like after Centennial stopped him on fourth down three drives ago, that maybe they had something going. You get the tipped ball interception and everything changed since then.
Hendricks on the toss, given back to Hendricks. And the catch. 2-point conversion is good.
Haven't seen that one, Larry. That was
not in tight quarters, you usually don't, right?
A little wrinkle. They throw the toss.
Yeah.
He pitches it back to the QB. Watch this. Hirschfeld did a good job staying with it defensively, but a nice throw and a little toe touch. Didn't even need it, but got two. Only needed one, got two. Three.
Wow. Great catch, fingertip catch by Leahy. Down on the field for Sean.
Lever knew that it was going to be a trick play as the play was developing. They said, watch the trick play, watch the trick play. So that gives you an idea when you play a team four times in 15 months, you've got a pretty good good idea about everything they do.
Just for the record, so everybody knows, when Sean is on camera, he doesn't have a hat on. But when he's not on camera, he has a hockey cap. I mean, he's a tough man and all.
He's bundled up.
But he takes that hat off to go on camera.
As I said earlier, at least he's in the outdoors. So when you were doing sidelines, you would have been inside one of those little cubby holes or corners or a locker room. We would have said, down to you on the field, Matt.
I'd have been making wind noises.
We would have heard a little echo.
Ball fell off the tee. Well, he kicked it into the end zone, but they called it back. Offsides.
Right, offsides, okay.
Have to re-kick it, 31 seconds to go in the third.
What a quarter here for UTAN, 21 to nothing. Three unanswered touchdowns.
Didn't really see this coming. The short field with the interception, then the one play 60-yarder, they hit him with the home run, and then another pick. I mean, you're going to go back and watch this game, and Centennial's going to feel like they dominated in most ways in the first half. And they weren't great offensively, but they held UTAN to 19 yards in the first half, and by the end of the third quarter, they're down 21 to nothing. Just crazy how quickly it turned.
Ball taken to the 22-yard line. Out to about the 33 or 34. There's Sean Callahan. Hey, Sean, that hat looks nice. Give us a wave.
Now take the hat off. There we go.
Oh, he's on camera. I want to remind you, Husker volleyball continues on NET Sports this Saturday as the Huskers take the court against Iowa. You can watch live action from the Devaney Sports Center beginning at 7 Central on NET, Nebraska's home for sports. So here we go. Completion from Ehlers. Hirschfeld out past midfield. Check that. That's Foreman out past midfield, quickly into Chieftain's territory.
So down to the 46-yard line. Probably one or two more plays here in the third quarter.
Ellers will keep it. Not much there as he runs into Lucas Powell's. Jaden Stewart is also there. We have fourth quarter action ahead in the last 4 minutes and 32 seconds. Two interceptions and three touchdowns makes it 21-0 UTAN.
Constellation believes in developing the next generation of Nebraska leaders, and we've shown that support by contributing more than $197,000 to 4-H and FFA in the 60 Nebraska counties we serve. Constellation supplies natural gas for Nebraska homes, farms, ranches, and businesses. Through our support for 4-H and FFA, we're providing energy for Nebraska's future as well. Natural gas supply from Constellation.
One to nothing here as we start quarter number four. Ball will be on the 43-yard line, and that's where the Broncos will try to get something going here in this fourth quarter. On the reverse, rolling to his right. Garon thought about throwing it, pulls it down, and Garon with an 11 or 12-yard gain, enough for a first down. Cooper Garon, just a freshman.
That's a nice play to get a first down. He's looking to throw it.
Yep.
Wasn't there. Get upfield. At least get a first down out of it. They need to score quickly. Scoring period would be they're looking.
Yeah, absolutely.
There they go.
Nice pass. Foreman steps through inside the 20-yard line down to the 18. And suddenly there is that sense of urgency they found here as Ellers completes to Foreman.
Klinecki was talking about that in the first half, how they dropped some passes that would have been big plays and put them in position to score.
Three wide to the top of the screen. Ellers looks that way. Tries to dump. Nobody there. He'll pull it down and carry and gets out of bounds. Forced out of bounds again by Pierce.
Ellers.
There is Klinecki expecting his first child in May.
That's exciting.
Yeah. It's a big year for him. The state championship.
Yeah, I think they're going to say Ellers was down.
Stewart and Feast both right there. This will be a loss of four. Brings up third and long.
Run a little stunt right in the middle of the defensive line. Feast comes underneath. He has been awesome today.
There is no feast or famine with him. It is all feast.
That's right. Nine tackles already, leading the way for that UTAN defense.
Third down and 13. Dumps it out of the backfield. Zone coverage.
That was a smart play, though.
Pierce was right there.
You know, get six or seven. Okay, now you have a chance on fourth down. Now you got to throw it past the sticks. But this is, to state the obvious, this is a must for Centennial. Have to have a first down or score to have a chance in this one.
The toss complete. Great grab. Hirschfeld pulls it in. That's enough for a first down inside the five. First and goal for Centennial.
Great design. Hirschfeld had to make sure he made the catch, so he went down to get it. He wanted to score here. He was led up the field just a little bit too much. So, but he had to do it. He had to go down to get it, make sure he got the first down.
10 minutes to go here in the game. Down 21-0, rolling to his right. Sees the pylon, got it. That's in there for a touchdown.
What a play.
Great stretch by Ehlers.
What a great play by Ehlers. They have stacked wideouts to the right side, Larry. They're just gonna sprint Ehlers out to the right. They have a receiver short and then one in the back of the end zone. He has two options on where to go with it. Hirschfeld's in the back. Foreman's running the crossing route. And then watch him lean right here. Boom, touchdown with the nose of the ball. Heck of a play by Ehlers.
So here's Tyler Perry, who is 10 of 13 on the year in PAT tries. And that is going to be off. Nine plays, 66 yards, 2:33 off the clock on that touchdown drive. On that very important touchdown drive for the Broncos. And now time to go play some defense. See if you can get the ball back. Plenty of time left here with 9:53 to go, down 21-6.
All right, probably not time for an onside kick yet, but you could.
Yep.
Sure could if you think, yeah, we're going to stop them. You like your defense and maybe try an onside kick.
So Minicucci and Purchill back deep for the Chieftains. UTAN with that now 21-6 lead. Caleb Cast in to kick it away. Angled toward Purchill, who takes it back to about the 24 on the return. Nice coverage.
All right, Centennial's crowd trying to give the boys a boost. They probably don't feel like they've been outplayed 21-6, but that is what the scoreboard says. And they need a quick stop here to get the ball back. I would guess UTAN's gonna keep it on the ground, try to burn some clock. They should.
So I'm from the 24-yard line, back in there at running back, Minicucci. Hendricks at quarterback. Give is to Minicucci. Nowhere to go is Quinn Butzke. The 6'2", 240-pound junior makes a nice play.
Yeah, he'll be back next year, leading the offensive and defensive lines. Big fella.
Coach Eitzman has been the defensive coordinator for the Centennial Broncos the last couple of years, and under his tutelage, they are 21-1. Since he's been the D coordinator. Coach Kleninski says he's just done a terrific job this year. So he loves to track numbers and keep track of numbers and look at it. Here goes Hendricks right up the middle. Hendricks into Bronco territory on a big carry for Griffin Hendricks.
I don't know if this was called or if he just did it, Larry. Nobody in the middle of the field. It's a quarterback draw, and it wasn't even really a draw. He just took it, took a couple steps back, and then bang, right up the middle. Unsure if it was called or not. Look at that. Smart play, broke two tackles, and a huge play for UT.
In the backfield, Minicucci has it. Not much there for the senior, Minicucci.
Oh, I think that's going to be,
might be
some sort of unsportsmanlike.
Game up.
We understood.
We got it. Yep.
Personal foul. Yep. On the defense. I think he kind of slammed Minicucci down. Let's see the end of the play.
Right at the end, yep.
Yeah, it's tough. It's a tough call. Minicucci was grabbed by the ankles by Bowers. And so Caleb Cast didn't really know that, obviously, and he just tried to tackle a guy and kind of throws him to the ground. It looked worse than it was. I don't think it was a play where he was trying to be malicious. I'm a big intent guy.
Right.
And I know the more gray area, the worse off you are when it comes to officiating. But I don't think the intent there was to hurt it.
Keeping it on the ground here with Minicucci, try to just chew clock here with 8:30 to go.
One more look at it. Yeah. I mean, if you're an official in the back there, I see why you call it.
Right.
But I think it was because his ankles were grabbed down below by Bowers.
Second down and 5 now. The toss to Minicucci. And they are going to ride their senior here down to the 10-yard line. Minicucci continues to drive. That's enough for a first down.
I think he got it. It's going to be a new set of downs. More time off the clock. The huge play on the quarterback draw was the big play by Hendricks on this possession.
Right.
They had tackled Minicucci behind the line of scrimmage on first down. Felt like maybe Centennial could get the ball back quickly.
Again, Hendricks to Minicucci. Aiden Richter's with the tackle, not much there. Brings up second down, inside 7:30 in. The time and the clock right now is the friend of the Chiefs. They have a 15-point lead and the ball deep in the Broncos territory. This would all but seal it here.
Yeah, they could get points here. Pretty much it's over. Or close to being over. They go first man through. Give it to Abraham.
Ball carried by Ethan. Down to the 5-yard line. The Broncos slowly feeling this one slipping away.
Clock is rolling, 6:40 left to go. How about Minicucci this afternoon? 29 carries, 74 yards. When he touches it again, probably right here, it'll be 30 carries.
Significant difference from, look out, Minicucci in for the touchdown. Another touchdown for Brylan Minicucci, and the senior is going to take his team to a state championship.
Second touchdown of the day, his 30th carry of the day, and that gets him to 80 yards. They've been tough yards for Minicucci today. Centennial's defense has done a nice job on him, but timely plays made by UTAN in this one are going to end up most likely being too much in this one for the Broncos of Centennial.
8 plays, 76 yards, and they chewed up 3 minutes and 30 seconds of clock. Going for 2 here. Did he catch it? They're going to say it hit the turf. Incomplete pass. So 27-6 is the score. And another look at this. Yeah, tough to tell from there.
Wow, that's it touched top of the turf.
Might have.
Pretty good grab.
Well, earlier today we asked you our Class C2 NSAA Championship trivia. Who holds the NSAA Class C2 and all-class record of most touchdown passes in a game? And Clayton Jeffries of Overton knew the answer was Brandon Stewart of Baird, 7 touchdowns back in 2010. So congratulations, Clayton. We'll be sending you out our NET t-shirt, size extra large.
Have any
2 for 2 today.
Mediums or larges down in the truck?
No, uh-uh. You have somebody who wants one? Could you just ask for a medium or
wear one of those in the morning when I have my coffee. Out of my
I just wonder why you were asking for a medium or a large then.
Well, you never know these days. They run big. Schmedium.
Taken to the 22-yard line by Foreman. Up to about the 29. Last time these two teams played, UTAN outgained Centennial 409 to 328. Outgained them by about 80 yards, but lost the game on that last second play with 41 seconds left. A wheel route from Ellers to Avery. That young man's had a nice afternoon, Minicucci.
Been a tough 80 yards, but he's gotten 80 yards. I don't blame you. You've earned the jacket. Put that baby on.
30 carries, a long of 11. And 2 touchdowns. They'll go up top. Got his man. Nice grab. First out of bounds is Hirschfeld.
Another nice gain. Ellers has a nice arm. Found Hirschfeld down the right side.
All down to the 45-yard line. 26-yard pass play. Now over the middle. That goes through the hands of Foreman.
That one go right through his hands?
Yeah.
It was a bullet. I know that. Foreman was running a shallow cross. Ellers threw a line drive, and I think it went through his hands. How about that?
Wow.
8 yards and 11 yards in the first, 19 yards.
Well, you mentioned who's going to make the adjustments, and I think it's part adjustment and part taking advantage of opportunities.
No question.
There were big opportunities that allowed them a quick strike score off of a turnover, big play, another turnover. That really gave them some momentum. Once that ball starts rolling, look out.
Yeah, a couple of interceptions. One was a tipped ball interception. And then the big play to Purchill.
Third down and 10. Ellers drops back over the middle. Has Hirschfeld. That's enough for a first down. Inside the 25, down to the 23-yard line. And a nice catch from Hirschfeld.
It's a good player, Hirschfeld. Yeah. Had a bunch of plays today. He's just a junior. He'll be back. Ellers is a junior, so we'll see that combination next year.
Looking over the middle, nothing there. Flag in the middle, and that's going to be a hold, and that will come back. And we see UTAN also not pressuring as much as they had early in the game with this 21-point lead.
Didn't see that.
Look at that.
I did not see that one, Larry. I don't think it was Ehlers who was face masked. I think it was an illegal hands in the face or something from a defensive lineman. But that's a big play to get it down to almost first and goal.
Usually right in the area that you would find holding, right in the middle of the line.
Yeah, put it down at the 11 and a half yard line.
So an opportunity here for Centennial. 5:34 to go. If we get a quick strike here, who knows, right?
Here we have, man. Timeout.
Timeout will be taken by Centennial.
Ooh.
Yeah. Those timeouts with 5:34 left, down by 21. Down to the field to Sean Callahan.
Yeah, Coach Krychek just didn't like the feel of things there. You could just sense that after that penalty. He thought about things and said, you know, let's take a timeout here. Let's catch our breath. You know, we've got this thing really on lockdown. Let's not mess anything up here and think about the situation we're in right now.
So, Sean, was the timeout taken then by Coach Krychek at UTAN?
Yes, Coach Krychek walked out to call the timeout.
Okay.
Our head official signaled that it was
taken by Centennial,
there,
yes.
Right.
And I think he's going to correct himself now.
So, good catch there, Sean.
And
here's a look at the scoring in the second half. The tip.
Tip pass.
Leahy with the interception. That led to this touchdown by Minicucci.
Which was huge because we had gone 2.5 quarters with no points. Then they get a stop and on first down go up top to Purchill and he just outruns the defense. And then we get down the middle. A great interception by Nelson when it didn't look like it was going to be intercepted. He runs it down inside the red zone and they score there. And then one more big drive. Had the big quarterback draw on that play, on that drive from Hendricks, ended up with a Minicucci touchdown.
Over the middle. Boy, had his man momentarily, could not pull it in, intended for Max Tomes.
Would have been a great catch.
Yeah.
It was a good throw and could have been six really quickly. Yeah, would have been a really good catch. But a good throw from Ehlers.
This offense is built for this. Little lob and picked off, intercepted, and that will about do it. Intercepted by Blake Hutton in the end zone.
Yeah, that was just essentially a jump ball. They said, okay, we have one-on-one. And Hutton was down there in coverage, and they just try to go to their tight end, try to throw it up to him. And it was underthrown and really not much of a chance for Haberman to go make a play.
.5:24 to go now here in the game. UTAN on top by 21, and now they get to work clock. Nice game for Griffin Hendricks. He's rushed the ball 6 times for 18 yards, 2 for 5 through the air, but both of those plays through the air were big plays, came at big moments. He had the big 60-yarder and another 28-yarder. It's a 31st carry by Minicucci, who's now at 81 yards in the game. Second down and 6. So many times in these state championship games, these are determined by a turnover here, a special teams play there, a big play. We've seen it all here, and they've all gone the way of UTAN.
No question, the third quarter, within just a 4 or 5 minute span of game time, this game got out of hand for Centennial. And UTAN just hung around, you know, in that first half, they couldn't get anything going offensively. Nothing at all. 19 yards and a half. I mean, this team, we talked about it at the top, but they lost their first three games of the year, and they were close games. But then they went on that winning streak, and they haven't lost since. There's the first down.
Minicucci with the carry, and that's a gain of about 6 yards on third down and two. I want to remind you, if you'd like a DVD copy of today's game from the NSAA High School State Championships, just call 800-868-1868 or visit netnebraska.org. Just $19.95 plus shipping and handling. You can relive all of the excitement from this year's championships for years to come.
Now burning clock, letting it go down under 5 seconds every time. UTAN's going to snap it, and they go.
A little pinball there, huh?
Yeah. Minicucci, yeah. They ran into his own guy, bounced backwards, almost a butt fumble. Got one out of it, and that'll be a timeout, I think, taken by Centennial.
Here's another look.
Yeah. Ooh. Runs into Abraham. The old New York Jets. Play they want to forget.
Yeah.
So Centennial taking one more shot to try to stop the clock here and force a punt and try to get it back. I think one more first down for UTAN will pretty much do it.
Well, what happens to the brain during a concussion is still a medical mystery. NET Sports examines head injuries and UNL's advanced brain research in concussions, heading for change. Hear from athletes who've suffered and see what's being done to prevent them. Concussions heading for change can be seen online at netnebraska.org/concussions and on the NET Nebraska app. Chieftains kind of afternoon. They lead it 27-6, 3:29 to go. Second down and eight. Scoots in there behind his offensive lineman. Minicucci with another gain of three or four. That'll bring up third down at about three.
And another timeout from Centennial. We'll have just one left after this.
Well, Nebraskan and founder of Mannheim Steamroller, Chip Davis, talks about producing 30 years of holiday music. You don't want to miss Mannheim Steamroller 3040 Live. It's Monday night, November 27th at 9 Central on NET. Plus, find out how you can get tickets to see Mannheim Steamroller live in Grand Island and in Omaha.
Best time of year coming up, Larry. Holiday season.
Thanksgiving this week.
It's always better when I don't have to drive to Iowa City for Thanksgiving. That's right. Home game.
That's right. Look at the total yards here. 130 on the ground, 88 through the air for UTAN.
That's going to do it. They're going to get a punt from UTAN. They're going to use their last timeout. So 3:17 to go, and they'll get the football back, but down three touchdowns.
Oh, three consecutive timeouts here for the Broncos and head coach Evan Klinensky. That will force the punt. If you love watching these high school championships on NET, we'd love to have you be part of our Sports Partners Club. For your generous donation to NET, you help us produce more than 200 hours of sports programming each year. You can show your support by joining the NET Sports Partners Club. At just $10 a month, we'll send you an exclusive NET Sports Partners Club fleece jacket. So to get your NET jacket, call 800-634-8000. 6788 or visit netnebraska.org/donate.
I don't have one of those either.
You got the coffee cup. You got it one step at a time here. Twilight here in Lincoln. As we are at the 5 o'clock hour, fourth down and three, and they're going to go for it. This could close it out if they get it on fourth down. Little roll to the left. That's going to be a nice waggle and good for a first down, and that's going to be enough to wrap this up. Now they can work clock and take home the school's first ever state title.
Good call there. You know, if you try to punt it, oh, there's a flag. This will take a minute to sort out, but that was...
Yeah, they're going to take that penalty. It's going to be against UTAN. So it's going to be a hold against UTAN. That will back them up 10 yards. And let's see now if they still decide to go for it, if they're going to punt this. We see a hold in there.
Yeah, right on the edge.
Edge, yep.
Yeah, that would have pretty much sealed it. A couple of handoffs and would have been over. Now you have to punt it, and we'll see if Centennial comes after it or if they just let him punt it away and try to get it back with good field position.
Punt up coming from Minicucci. Minicucci drops back and handles the deep snap. And it will be... Thought about it there, didn't he? Foreman was trying to get in there late, see if he could steal one. Get an easy six.
Yeah, and UTAN did the right thing there by letting the clock run as long as it would before the official blew the whistle.
2:39 to go. Centennial back out of the field, down by three touchdowns. What a season for Dan Krychek. Think about losing your first three games out of the chute. You lose to Battle Creek 14-12. You come back the next week, you lose to this Centennial team on a last second play with 41 seconds left. They beat you 28-25. You come back the next week, Loganview hands it to you 27-20, and all of a sudden, you're questioning what kind of season you're gonna have when you thought you had a pretty good team, and you're 0-3. Then you find out your opponent doesn't want to play the next week, but you either can't, you're not enough players, so that's a forfeit. Then they went on that run, starting with Elmwood Murdoch.
Well, sometimes it's confidence. Sometimes it's scheme. They found a way.
Intercepted. Picked off by Purchill. Read it well, reacted, and gets the interception.
Yeah, I mean, this game did not look good really for either team for a while. It just wasn't a lot happening. But UTAN has done a lot of this, taking advantage of opportunities that Centennial provided to them with interceptions, turnovers, short fields, and now just a few handoffs, and they can lift the trophy.
Fourth interception of the game for the Chieftains. ...15 points off of those turnovers. NET Television's Nebraska Stories returns in January. New season coming up of stories from around Nebraska. You can watch Nebraska Stories each week beginning Thursday, January 7th at 8 p.m. on NET. Up there. Clock ticked down. Minicucci with the carry, tries to spin away, and we're inside 140. Third down coming up here for the Chieftains.
Minicucci just grinding yards out. Now finally over 100. 37 for 102.
Wow.
That's a lot of quotes.
Not kidding.
Well, get ready for basketball right after the state football championship.
He will have carried by the end of this season, he will have had 270 carries on the year. And that's enough for a first down. That would allow them to continue to work the clock down to the 40-yard line. Nice carry and a first down by Hendricks.
Yeah. Now you can just take a knee and call it good. Well done by UTAN here in the second half. Opportunistic, cashed in on those opportunities. Didn't give opportunities back to Centennial. Didn't really, throw a ball that could have been a pick six. Didn't put it on the turf. Just really cleaned it up and did a great job in the second half of doing enough to get a lead and then built on it. They got Centennial in a position where they weren't comfortable. Down 14-0, then they throw another pick, trying to come back where they hadn't been behind much this year.
Right.
And you're 12-0, you're expecting to win. Feel like you're dominating the first half. You get to the third and you're down 14-0. Feel like you've outplayed them. And UTAN, from that point on, added a couple more touchdowns and one going away. We didn't see that happening in the first half.
Handshakes and hugs all around. Dan Krychek, you can see him pacing the sideline, excited. They hadn't been in the state championship game since 1988. They were runners-up in 85 and in 88. And the UTAN fans on their feet here at Memorial Stadium. For the first time in school history, Chieftains are state champs.
Awesome. Just an awesome feeling for this community, the UTAN Chieftains, with their first state championship in football, and really happy for them. Hopefully these kids can go have a party tonight and enjoy with their families and their parents and all the people from their community that came to Lincoln to support them today. This is a big deal for them. Congratulations.
Might be kind of fun to be in UTAN tonight, huh?
I might be in UTAN. There's a chance. Get done with the Class A game, I'll go to UTAN.
We might head up there. That'll be a fun night. Well, congratulations once again. A terrific season for both Centennial and UTAN. Chieftains are champs. Medals and trophies when we come back here at Memorial Stadium in Lincoln.
With the Aurora Cooperative, you have a trusted partner who looks well beyond the horizon. We're putting our owner's equity to work every day by anticipating what you'll need tomorrow, creating what's next for your farm, a portfolio of innovation that supports every aspect of your operation, and an unwavering commitment to your success, however you measure it.
My farm, my cooperative, my future.
The Aurora Cooperative.
You're watching NET Television.
NET is able to take the best of programming that's available from national sources like NPR or PBS and augment that or supplement that with programming that we create specifically for the citizens of our state. There may be specific topics that are unique to Nebraska that we are able to address. They may be about documentary topics like pandemic or sex trafficking. They may be sports programs that put our citizens in touch with Husker football action every single week, like Big Red Wrap-Up. They may be the high school sports championships that allow citizens from all over the state to participate with their high school team. With NET, our purpose is to serve the citizens of the state, and we do that through the programs that we broadcast, through the programs that we create, and the services that we provide to make our communities healthier and better.
Coverage of the 2017 NSAA High School Football Championships on NET is made possible in part by Nebraska Public Power District, Nebraska Soybean Board, Education Quest, Methodist College, Constellation, and Aurora Cooperative. A big thank you to all of our sponsors who help us bring you the best high school athletes from across the state. We could not do it without your support. Welcome back to Memorial Stadium. UTAN wins at 27-6 in the state championship in Class C2. And now for medal and trophy presentations. As soon as we let you know how to get an DVD of this state NSAA high school championship game, just give us a call at 800-868-1868. Or you can log onto our website at netnebraska.org, follow the prompts, and just for $19.95, you can have a copy of these state high school championships. And now let's go to Steve Lemon for medal and trophy presentations.
Nebraska School Activities Association, honored to have medals and trophies for both of these outstanding teams. Presentations will be made by NSAA Executive Director, Dr. Jim Tenneper, NSAA Board of Directors, Nolan Beyer from Millard Public Schools, Kathy Wieskamp from Lincoln Public Schools, and U.S. Bank Representatives, Melissa Harnish and Aaron Roush Conaway. Here are the awards for runner-up Centennial High School. Head coach Evan Klinensky and his assistants will present the silver medals. Players, please come forward as your name is called. Number one, Alion Thompson. Number two, Ian Schluter. Number three, Jackson Hirschfeld. Number five, Ryan Payne. Number six, Max Tone. Number seven, Reese Foreman. Number 11, Nate Hanneman. Number 14, Wyatt Collingham. Number 15, Gage Baltrip. Number 16, Cooper Guerin. Number 17, Wyatt Shep. Number 22, Wyatt Ellers. Number 24, Sid Farley. Number 28, Joel Bargan. Number 30, Andrew Wellman. Number 35, Braden Haberman. Number 38, Gavin Avery. Number 40, Robert Delgado. Number 41, Hayden Richters. Number 42, Jake Prohaska. Number 45, Keith Haberman. Number 51, Tyler Perry. Number 55, Austin Nave. Number 57, Caleb Cast. Number 68, Quinn Butzke. Number 70, Cole Goki. Number 71, Elijah Wazorik. Number 72, Garrett Bellhoffer. Number 73, Cody Bender. Number 78, Alton Bowers. These outstanding athletes and their school, here is the 2017 NSAA Class C2 State Football Runner-Up Trophy. Congratulations, Centennial High School.
Let's go, boys. We got to go.
Let's go.
Let's go, boys.
Let's go.
So there are the runners up from Centennial. Class C2 runner up. Knocked off UTAN earlier this year in a tight game. A late score gave them the win. Difficult, certainly, to come down here looking for a state title and finish runner-up, but what a great season.
Undefeated till you get to Memorial Stadium. And in the first half, it looked like they were doing enough to win. Looked like in the second half, it was just gonna be a grind down to the last possession. And a couple of mistakes here and there really cost them, and UTAN took advantage.
So time now for the medal and trophy presentations for the champs from UTAN. Let's go back to Steve.
Now to the champions, UTAN High School. Head coach Dan Krychek, we have a special award for you. Coach Krychek and his assistants will present the gold medals. Players, please come forward as your name is called. Number four, Brett Heyerts. Number five, Chase Herschel. Number nine, Griffin Hendricks. Number 11, Dyson Judas. Number 12, Sean Hinkle. Number 14, Logan Moen. Number 15, Clayton Nelson. Number 18, Will Elgert. Number 20, Eric Leahy. Number 21, Jamie Eamon. Number 22, Ryland Menicucci. Number 23, Blake Hutton. Number 27, Levi Larson. Number 30, Ethan Strand. Number 31, Hayden Egger. Number 33, Alex Watson. Number 36, Ethan Abraham. Number 37, Emily Fisher. Number 47, Alan Leahy. Number 51, Sam Elgert. Number 53, Trevor Stevens. Number 55, Parker Pierce. Number 60, Colton Feast. Number 62, Jaden Stewart. Number 66, Lucas Powells. Number 68, Cole Egger. Number 72, Caden Hufstedler. Number 73, Jay Royal. Number 78, Tyler Pinkelman. Number 80, Jay Smith. Number 81, Preston Pierce. Number 85, Caleb Beitler. Number 88, Dylan Bart. Presenting the championship game ball from Farmers Mutual Insurance is Vice President of Agencies, Andy Krause. Now for these outstanding athletes and their school, here is the 2017 NSAA Class C2 State Football Championship Trophy. Congratulations, UTAN High School.
Congratulations to the Chieftains. They are state champs in Class C2. First ever state championship, and what a third quarter it was that led them to that title.
It's a feeling that these guys will never forget, and a bond that will bring them together probably every 10 or 20 years from here on out, and they'll remember playing in this stadium. Just an unbelievable day for the players from UTAN and that whole community.
Let's get out of the field to Sean.
Guys were the victorious head coach Dan Krychek. Coach, 0-3, And a lot of people are like, wow, where's this season going? And not only did you get back to Lincoln, you finished the deal here tonight. How does it feel to finally get this done?
Well, I just feel great for these kids. You know, they did this. You know, they brought us coaches along for the ride. We just try and get them in the right positions, and they make the plays. You know, it's you can't do this without special kids, and that's what we had this year. So that's why we're able to get it done.
You guys were really able to break open. It was 0-0 at the half, and you come out with 27 points here in the second half. You had that little spurt with the wind behind your back. You took the shot play downfield. How did you really break this game open?
You know, we just had to be patient. They were putting nine guys in the box and playing man-to-man. And when you do that, you can't do that a whole game against a good team and expect not to give up some big plays. In the first half, we knew, got a couple of these plays were close, a couple of them were close. Just stick with it, and we're going to get it. And that's kind of been our attitude all year, and it works. This team responds to that, so they do a pretty good job with that.
Well, let's bring in some of these guys here as we have Colton Feast and Braylon Maricucci. Come on in here, guys, both of you guys here, as we talk about the championship. Colton, 0-3, and you guys were in a rough spot this year, and to get into Lincoln and get it done, how did you guys stay together as a team?
We just know that we've been working hard throughout summer and everything, and we know that if we did everything we could, it'd work out. So we just kept going to work every day, and it all worked out for us in the end. So, yeah.
What was the mindset in the second half for you guys? A 0-0 game, it was kind of a stalemate, and you guys were able to break this thing open.
Yeah, we knew that our deep would probably hold up. Had to stay on our blocks on offense and give my man, Brown Minicucci, a little path, and he'll get through it. So that's kind of what we did, and stuck on our blocks, and it all worked out.
Let's bring in Rylan. Talk about your night. I mean, you carried the ball over 30 times. How's your body hanging up after a game like that?
A little sore right now, but, you know, I got to do what I got to do. Just keep running, keep getting 3 yards every pop, and then hopefully one breaks. And, you know, I got to give it up to my line. They do an incredible job just breaking holes open, and I'll find the seam and get it done.
This was the fourth time you guys have played Centennial in the last 15 months. How well did you know that team on the other sidelines, and what did you think it was going to take to get the job done tonight?
I felt like we knew them pretty good. We've been practicing against them four times, like you said. So we knew them, like, their ins and outs, and I just thought we just had to play our game like we knew how to.
What's this championship mean to UTAN?
Means everything, man. It's incredible. It's an incredible experience. It's just awesome. I'm in awe right now.
Well, hey, congratulations. Go over there and celebrate with your teammates, guys.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Guys, back up to you.
First ever state championship for UTAN. That's a special one. Those guys, as you said, a big part of that state championship run and the win after an 0-3 start to make that kind of run. I mean, who would have thought at 0-3 that they would be here holding that state championship trophy.
Impressive win. And when they were getting their medals, I could see they have some dudes on that team. Big
right.
Dudes.
Yeah,
so congratulations to UTAN. This is going to be a fun night for the Chieftains.
I want to remind you, coming up later tonight, 7 o'clock right here on NET Sports, we'll have the final championship of our 2 days here at Memorial Stadium, the Class A title. It will feature the Bearcats of Kearney and the Vikings of Omaha North. That should be a great battle to close it out here from Memorial Stadium. So one final time for Matt Davison, for Sean Callahan, I'm Larry Putnick. For our entire NET Sports production crew, thanks so much for joining us. UTAN wins the state championship. We'll see you back here tonight on NET Sports.